Kia ora, good morning. Look at you two. Tova O'Brien and Mark Day in the studio. Welcome, guys.
Welcome. Thank you. I've been thinking about this moment for so long. I cannot believe I'm actually physically in the same place as you guys. We're in a studio together, and today
it's remarkable. I know. I just want to say I've ironed out a few creases this morning. I've had a few little hiccups, but I took one for the team.
I have a sneaky suspicion we're going to find a couple more creases between now and 9 o'clock.
Yeah, I think so too. It's going to be a linen suit.
No, it's been so good to hear you back on the radio.
Yeah, it's been good. 4 years. We were between drinks, to
I
be
know.
Fair.
I feel like the last time you were broadcasting, I was broadcasting, so yeah. there's some symmetry there somehow.
And I never have broadcasted.
No.
Hey.
Welcome to the world of radio.
Thanks,
Ray.
How was your first light?
It was fun, actually. It was really fun. It's good to be back on air. And like I say, a few little wrinkles. And I think you'll probably notice this, Tova. I mean, Mark's seasoned professional on radio over here. But, you know, I've come from television as well in the past and come into radio. Radio's fabulous because it's just so intimate. Like, you'll be in people's bedrooms at the moment. You'll be in their cars. It's such a lovely media. It's my favourite. You will love it. You will love it.
Thank you for welcoming me into your bedroom this morning.
And you've got some big interviews.
Sometimes it's best not to think about it, really.
Haven't you? Yeah, you've got some big stars on your show this morning.
She's going to be chocker. I'm not actually entirely sure how we're going to fit it all in, so let's just hope nothing else happens in the meantime. But we've got Winston Peters, Rob Fyfe, Peter Beck, Helen Clark, John Key, Yulia Mendel, Andrew Little, Chris Luxon, and many, many more. And a lot of those people are going to be drawing on some of the things that you talked about on your show, these issues with China. If China gets in behind Russia, what's New Zealand going to do?
Absolutely. This is amazing. You've got lots to do. You've got lots to be cracking on with, so I should let you get on with it. So good to have you here.
Lovely to see you.
Thanks, Rachel.
It is a really big lineup this morning.
It is. And do you know what? Just is the cherry on the top and the thing that I'm looking forward to particularly, a chance to win $5,000. I've never given away money before like this en masse. We're giving away $5,000 with a $5,000 question. One question, 10 seconds. If you're right, the cash is yours. The question is completely gettable. We don't know what it is yet. That's happening at 7:35. Mm-hmm. I'm pumped about this.
That is exciting. Yeah, it's weird. Why doesn't the news give away cash? Maybe they should. Maybe they're missing a trick. But you know, this is quintessential radio. You're on the radio now. You're giving away cash.
Exactly, and I'm glad that they don't because it's now our domain. It is 6:32. Carly's now in with the headlines.
Today FM headlines.
Welcome, Tova and Mark. Well, Cabinet is set to meet this afternoon to discuss vaccine mandates and the traffic light system. Auckland's Newmarket Business Association says it's time for orange, with many stores and restaurants already closing. Political parties are being urged to collaborate to help move forward with the pandemic. Epidemiologist Professor Michael Baker says the government should reconvene the Epidemic Response Committee. And a watchful eye is being kept on China over its response to the war in Ukraine. The US's new information suggesting it's open to providing Russia with military and financial assistance. And in sport, Ferrari driver Charles Leclerc has won the opening race of the Formula One season, the Bahrain Grand Prix. PureSouthShop.com, delivering New Zealand's finest red meat straight to your door. More news as soon as it happens on Today FM.
Thanks, Carly. It's 6:33. An art school sheltering more than 400 people was shelled by Russian forces, becoming the latest target in the already devastated city of Mariupol.
Today FM. News Bites.
They lie where they died. So many bodies all over Mariupol. City council officials say Russian soldiers are forcibly deporting several thousand residents to Russian territory. Resident Lyudmila Slivka said they didn't have much choice. The Russian soldiers gave us 10 minutes, saying, if you want to live, go.
There's been a record surge of coronavirus cases in Germany just as the country gets ready to remove nearly all pandemic restrictions.
In countries like Germany and Austria, we're actually seeing record infections again. Most health experts are in agreement on what's driving this. First, people are mixing with each other at levels they hadn't in a long time, and often without masks. Second, the latest dominant strain, BA.2, is even more transmissible than Omicron that began washing over the world in November and December.
And Kiwi-Canadian country and soul singer Tammy Nielsen has had her dream come true, with country legend Willie Nelson joining her for a duet at the annual Luck Reunion Festival in Texas.
Beyond the sunlight,
Tammy.
I know, so cool.
Dreams really do come true. Just case in point, standing in the studio here with you, Mark.
Oh, yeah, you'll keep. I was going to ask, actually, is there somebody that you would really, really, really love to meet that you'd like to maybe not sing with, but spend some time with and hang out with?
Just definitely not to sing with, because because that would be a disaster. But I've been watching Vladimir Zelensky on CNN this morning, and I would love to spend some concerted time with that man. What a kind of magnificent human.
Yeah, yeah.
What about you?
I don't know, actually. I should have thought of that. I should have thought about that before I asked you the question.
And that's
how it feels. Yeah, I know.
To be put on the
spot. I would like to talk to an ex-president just to find out whether or not aliens are real.
Yeah, totally. Well, do you know who we ask about whether aliens are real later in the program? Peter Beck, CEO of Rocket Labs, the guy who builds the rockets to go and find the aliens. So he's actually a very good source of intel on this. Stay tuned.
Tova.
In the United States, President Joe Biden is due to travel to Europe later this week to meet with NATO leaders to discuss the ongoing crisis in Ukraine. With that and more, we're joined by Washington-based correspondent Jagruti Dave. Jagruti, thank you for joining us. All eyes on President Biden's trip to the NATO summit in Brussels on March 24th. Can we expect real action to come out of this, or just another talk fest?
Well, I think some people argue that this is a very much a symbolic trip by US President Joe Biden, a show of solidarity with Ukraine, but also a show of solidarity amongst Western allies, to send a message to Russian President Vladimir Putin. So I think there is some pessimism as to whether there's going to be any actual action further than what's already been done. Remember, the US and European countries have put together quite an enormous package of sanctions against Russia in the wake of its invasion of Ukraine. But of course, what President Zelensky has been calling for are things like a no-fly zone, jets for Ukraine, which Joe Biden has, and Western allies have said no to, because they fear a no-fly zone could trigger a war with Russia, as with jets to Ukraine and troops on the ground is something that Joe Biden has also ruled out. So I think, it's unclear as to whether there's going to be any actual action as a result of this, and whether this is just a symbolic move. Remember also, Jen Psaki has just said that the White House press secretary, that the president will not be visiting Ukraine while he is there, which is very interesting. Several European leaders had recently gone to Ukraine. So you had neighboring countries, the prime ministers of Poland, Czech Republic and Slovenia, who met with President Zelensky, Ukraine's president, in Kiev. But Joe Biden will not be doing that. And I think it's just an indication of the difficult position that Ukraine, that the United States is in. Clearly they want to support Ukraine, but they're also conscious that anything that is viewed as escalatory by Russia is in serious danger of triggering a potentially frightening response. World War III is something that President Zelensky has been talking about. So I think this is something that the West really wants to avoid for obvious reasons.
And Jagruti, on another topic, camped outside Washington, the trucker convoy has arrived. They're rallying against COVID restrictions, but fueled by such a broad set of grievances. Where does that go from here?
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? Because these demonstrations have been sparked by similar protests that happened in Canada against vaccine mandates.
We saw them here too in New Zealand.
And there are similar concerns by demonstrators here in Washington, D.C. over the weekend. There were some roads that were blocked off by police as they tried to sort of control the convoy of trucks that were approaching the U.S. Capitol. But as you say, they are fueled by wider grievances. And what you hear from protesters, not just talking about mask mandates, but also talking about the erosion of freedoms in general. The New York Times went and spoke to a few of these protesters, and they were sort of complaining about the education system and worries about abortion rights or abortion laws or the restriction of gun rights. And you also heard some of the familiar baseless claims about fraud in the 2020 presidential election. So I think where it goes from here really is a look ahead to the midterms as to how much of these sorts of sentiments are really expressive of the wider right in the United States, whether that is something that is going to feed into those elections.
Absolutely.
As Joe Biden tries to consolidate his position.
We hope, Jagruti, that they don't escalate in the way that we saw here in New Zealand. Thank you very much for your time. Our Washington-based correspondent, Jagruti Dave. It's 6:40 a.m. Coming up at 7:35 this morning, your chance to win $5,000 with our $5,000 question. One question, 10 seconds. If you get it right, $5,000 is yours. And before 7, Winston Peters on vaccine mandates. We also talked to Ukraine former press secretary, the former press secretary to President Volodymyr Zelensky, Yulia Mendel.
Get in quick. Trade Depot has lowered the prices just for you on thousands of new bathrooms, kitchen and laundry appliances. 250 litre deep freezers from $350. Front loader washing machines from $399. Huge French door side-by-side fridge freezers from $999. Hurry into the Sockburn showroom or shop online now at Trade Depot. With minimum spends, get free home delivery in Canterbury. T's and C's apply. TradeDepot.co.nz.
If you test positive for COVID-19, register your result at mycovidrecord.nz. You'll then receive a text with some instructions to make sure you get the health and welfare support you need. Registering also helps with contact tracing. You and your household will need to isolate for 7 days. People in your household need to get tested on day 3 and day 7, or if they develop any symptoms. For more information, visit covid19.govt.nz/positive.
House and land packages have been harder to find than a cheap cauliflower. But great news. Today Homes have secured sections in popular Rolleston and Hallswool. They can build your dream design or select from one of the many Today Homes plans. These home and land packages are selling fast, so don't muck around. Talk to one of the good guys at Today Homes. Catch them at one of their 4 stunning Rolleston show homes or pick up the phone. Locations, opening hours and contact details all at todayhomes.co.nz. Making home building easy for 34 years. Today Homes.
Hi, I'm Cheryl. Our team at Dignity with Sincerity Funeral Services, Christchurch's only funeral company owned and operated by a woman. For over 30 years, we've been helping Cantabrians cope with grief when a loved one passes. We've introduced the special benefits for gold card holders. Whether the farewell is big or small, formal or relaxed, we offer not just the best value, but service that is all about respect and dignity. If you need us, please call 36 55055.
Hey mate, can you shut my phone?
Yeah, sure thing.
Heads up! And he's under it! He's under it! Don't fumble it! Don't fumble it!
Cheers.
Oh, that's a superb catch in the deep.
Catch the cricket this summer on Today FM and Rover. Exclusive coverage of the Black Caps and White Ferns. Proudly brought to you by First Mortgage Trust. Looking for an investment with good delivery? Learn more at fmt.co.nz. Catch the cricket on Today FM and Rover with First Mortgage Trust, the smart investment choice.
The countdown is on.
Who's the greatest Kiwi of all time?
Coming soon on Today FM.
Good morning and welcome to the brand new Today FM with Tova O'Brien and Mark Dye. Thanks to Generate, the KiwiSaver specialists. Generate is a specialist KiwiSaver provider focused on helping Kiwis grow their savings to achieve the lifestyle they want in retirement. It's 6:44 a.m, 6:45. Supply chain issues could get even worse with further lockdowns in China, where about a third of the world's manufacturing comes from. We're seeing on the shelves in supermarkets here, right? We're seeing it on the shelves everywhere.
Everywhere, yeah. I mean, if you're after anything at the moment, it seems to be difficult to get it. I mean, we've had massive issues with my business bringing stuff in, you know, sort of 3 or 4 month delays. Obviously, that has flow-on effects for our customers as well. And yeah, I mean, every day you go to the supermarket, are you going to get whatever it is that you're after?
Yeah, have you faced any significant delays? I mean, obviously your business is significant.
Work stuff aside, I mean, I've been to the supermarket a couple of times. I went to get pineapple juice the other day. There was no, like, pineapples in a can. I was like, where is all this gone? Why is there none of that? I didn't know whether that was supply chain or just no one to stack the shelves.
Yeah.
But you're still missing a beard, aren't you?
I'm missing a bed. I ordered a bed. I moved to Auckland sometime mid-Jan, ordered a bed set sometime around there. It was supposed to be here end of Feb. It's now going to be another couple of months, I think. So I've got this kind of London squat scene going on in my bedroom where I'm just sleeping on a mattress on the floor. But, you know.
See, it's the funny thing. People think working in the media is so glamorous. But, you know, this big job and your own show and you go home and you're sleeping in a squat.
Sleeping on the floor. I'm more worried, actually, about I'd ordered 100 by accident masks, KN95 masks, which have been delayed as well. And those are probably a little bit more pertinent at the minute.
I'm sure they'll get here just in time for the end of the pandemic.
Yeah, precisely. Yeah, precisely, yeah. Just like our rat tests. We want to know if you've faced any mega delays, if you've been missing anything from the shelves. Carly, what about you? Have you faced any big delays?
I'm just thinking about you, Tova, having to sleep on the floor. You know, sleep when you're getting up at the time that we're getting up on this new show is very, very, very important. Are you sleeping well? I mean, don't worry about tonight, you'll be absolutely exhausted, but last night you probably didn't get much sleep anyway, right?
No, super, super wide. It does help you get out of bed in the morning. It's not the greatest, you know, like just lying on the perspective. It's all back.
No, look, I think the pandemic has, you know, a couple of years ago prepared me for a few things. I even have my loo paper on subscription these days. It's fantastic.
What?
I know. It wow. turns up really? Every 3 or 4 months. It's beautifully wrapped. It's called Eco Roll. I love it. I never have to worry about that. Same with my toothpaste.
Where do you store 3 to 4 months with the toilet paper? How big is your house?
In her underground bunker because she's hoarding for the episode.
Oh, don't you have 3 kids? I've got an arc.
Well, that's why I have to buy so much toilet paper, Mark.
We want to know what you're hoarding, what you're missing, if you're facing any major delays. Text us on 3920. It is 6:46, and now Carly is back with the headlines.
Today FM headlines.
Thanks, Tova. Fears about an uptick of cases in the wake of St Patrick's Day. Thousands of students flocked to the streets of Dunedin. Infectious diseases physician Professor Kirk Crowell says most cases will not have shown up yet. It comes as Cabinet plans to meet to discuss vaccine mandates and the traffic light system today, with many businesses pleading for a move to orange. Ukraine's president is pleading with his Russian counterpart for negotiations. Vladimir Zelensky told CNN he'll do anything to stop the war. And a wet and overcast day for people in the north. Severe thunderstorm warnings are in place across the country, including in Auckland and the Coromandel. PureSouthShop.com, delivering New Zealand's finest red meat straight to your door. More news as soon as it happens on Today FM.
Thanks, Carly. It's nearly 10 to 7. There's no topic that's divided New Zealanders more than vaccine mandates over the past few months. Joining us now is a staunch opponent of them, New Zealand First Leader Winston Peters. Morena, Mr. Peters, thank you for joining us.
Good morning. But look, I was not a staunch opponent of vaccine mandates. I'm a staunch opponent of them being kept on far too long.
Okay.
When we didn't have the utilities that we've got now, they made sense, but they've long since lost the sense or the logic to them, and we should have moved on.
Gotcha. It looks like the government is set to drop the mandates, the passes and the gathering limits, and those are things that you've argued for, as you say, more recently. Isn't there an argument, though, that they timed it right, waiting for that peak to peak?
No, there's not an argument on that. It seems to me that all the knowledge and all the epidemiologists and all the modellers in this country, we have a concern that no one was watching what was happening internationally as close as they should have, because it's obvious to us now that we've gone through the peak, and yet not one modeler picked it. As you well know, they were saying it's going to be April. So in the end, yes, it makes a lot of sense, but the reality is they should have watched more closely in national circumstances, in Australia in particular, and we could have moved in and out of this much more quickly, because it's cost. There's so many people, businessmen and workers, there's so much. It costs them, some people, everything they've ever worked for.
Is there an argument for mandates to remain in some areas, perhaps with the health workforce, given the strains on the system there?
Well, if there's such an argument, it's made illogical straight away by the government saying that people who have got COVID, doctors who have got COVID, can nevertheless go back and work into hospitals.
Mm.
Any logic goes flying out the window when people see that.
The health system is, you know, it's pretty much at capacity. Reports of just 4 available staffed ICU beds last week. Couldn't this be, when we lift these COVID restrictions, couldn't this be the blowout for our overworked, under-resourced health workforce?
But it's already blown out. That's the reality.
But couldn't it blow out further if we lift restrictions?
Yeah, but when you were hearing every day from the podium of truth that there were 22 or 21 or 20,000 per day, it was never that figure. Very belatedly, the epidemiologists have said No, it was two or three times that. Now, that is the truth. So instead of saying that it could blow out, let me just say to you, I believe it already has blown out and the figures are coming down now.
You haven't had COVID, have you?
Now, how on earth would you ask that question? The answer is no.
Well, curious, and I saw you walking around without a mask among people who turned out to be a bit of a super spreader event. Someone else who was also at that protest, another former politician, former National MP Matt King, who took Northland off you. He's also kind of shunning mandates now. Would you ever join forces with Matt King? He's starting this new political party.
Well, I got no idea what Matt King was doing at all. And the reality was that you had a protest at Parliament, and over the years, in fact, for centuries, when there's been protests, people have been talked to. In this one unique case, every parliamentarian, led by the Prime Minister and the Cabinet, decided they wouldn't talk to them, just boycott them. Even worse, they were calling some people scum. Now, look, I happened to have been persuaded to go in the very end by a business that was going for 52 years and going bust because the government would not allow certain changes in parts of this country's economy. 52 years and going bust, and one of those people was there. And that was the person that was what dissuaded me. Something had to be done. Somebody needed to talk to them. And to call them all criminals and this and that and scum, I think it's a darn disgrace. And how you can get away with it as a Labour Party cabinet minister is beyond me.
Well, probably you can't make sweeping generalisations about anyone at the protest, but they were your example, slightly marred by the fact that people were out there holding signs talking about lynching politicians and journalists.
Well, yeah, that's a fraction of idiots and nutcases and everything else. You'll always get those. And every protest I've ever seen has had the marginalisation of people misusing the event. But the mass majority were ordinary, decent people. I saw business people, lawyers, doctors, all sorts of people that were there. And to image them as that, I think it's just shameful.
You've told my You've told my producer that you don't want to talk about Tauranga and whether you'll stand in the by-election. Is that because you haven't decided yet whether you want to stand?
Look, you have a lovely day.
No, but Mr. Peters, are you going to stand in the Tauranga by-election? Beep, beep, beep. I'm taking that silence as Winston Peters hanging up on me. Okay,
He's got a couple of fans, though, for turning up to those protests. There's a couple of people who have texted and said, please thank Mr. Peters for actually having a conversation with us. I didn't see any lawyers, though, did you?
I mean, it was hard to tell. It was hard to see. It was hard to separate the wheat from the chaff, so to speak, at that protest. But, you know, he raises some valid points, and I'm going to take his silence as undecided about whether or not he is going to run in that Tauranga by-election created by Simon Bridges' resignation. It is 6:53, 7 minutes to 7. Coming up at 7:35 this morning, your chance to win $5,000 with our $5,000 question. And next, we talk the Ukraine with former Press Secretary to President Volodymyr Zelensky, Yulia Mendel.
Today FM Weather Check.
Well, it's a mostly cloudy day in the Garden City today. Some drizzle possibly in the morning and then rain or drizzle from the afternoon. Nor'easterlies about as well. It'll be a warm one though, 20 degrees the high.
Today FM traffic.
Shower dome, shower tops.
A cloudy day ahead around the Garden City. We're in for a high of 20 degrees. And coming into town right now, it's all pretty quiet out there on the roading network. We're not seeing any delays at this stage. We'll let you know when they do start to build towards peak hour. Just a heads up that coming up on Wednesday night after 8 p.m, the Waimate River Bridge is closed city bound. You'll have to detour via the old bridge, but it remains open heading northbound.
Eliminate shower steam by simply fitting a shower dome. showerdome.co.nz.
It's time to boost your whānau protection. Now is a great time to get your booster. If your kura aged tamariki are yet to be vaccinated, bring them along so you can all get protected together. Book at bookmyvaccine.nz or call 0800 282926.
Leanne's got a bad habit of putting things into the too hard basket.
Sorting my business admin, finding time for lunch, reconciling bank statements, you name it.
Get your admin out of the too hard basket with 50% off Xero for 3 months. Visit Xero.com to get started. Terms apply.
This may sound like a summer Barbie, but listen carefully.
So, yeah, business is tough right now.
Well, I can help. I'll just leave this on the table while I grab you another vino.
Your price list?
Yeah. So you can match it. Then we both make more profit.
Count me in.
It's actually the scene of a crime. Price fixing. And under cartel law, it could mean jail time. If you see it, report it, stop it. See the Commerce Commission website for details.
Now's the time to buy that heat pump. Hi, Dave from BDR. Buy your home heat pump from us before the 31st of March and save yourself $100 on each unit. There's plenty of summer left, so stay cool with an air-conditioned unit from BDR. And when the winter months hit, you'll be enjoying toasty warm comfort. Don't miss out. Buy your heat pump before 31st of March and save $100 on each unit for your home. Conditions apply. BDR.co.nz or phone 0800 80 85 80. BDR, unbeatable.
Listing a property? See why Bailey's Canterbury is altogether better at baileys.co.nz. Bailey's Canterbury sell residential, rural, lifestyle, commercial and industrial. So if you're listing a property, do it better with Bailey's. They're New Zealand's largest full-service real estate company. Baileys.co.nz. Your first choice for listing. Licensed REA 2008.
Find out more.
Tova.
With Generate, the KiwiSaver specialists. People you can actually talk to.
On Today FM.
More than 3.3 million people have fled Ukraine as the war with Russia continues to escalate. Hundreds are dead, and many of those still alive in cities like Mariupol have been cut off completely. Here to tell us about the situation on the ground, we're joined by the former press secretary to President Volodymyr Zelensky, Yulia Mendel. Yulia, thank you for joining us. What is the latest there from Ukraine? We're just going to go Hi, Yulia, can you hear me?
Yes, do you hear me?
I do. Yeah, can you give us an update, the latest on the ground there?
Yes, thank you. So Russians really continue attacking Ukraine from different parts, and the northern part of Ukraine and the eastern part of Ukraine suffered most. We saw that there were really heavy bombardment and shelling in eastern cities of Donbass and Kharkiv, which actually are Russian-speaking territories, and that Vladimir Putin tries to pretend to be saving from Ukrainian-speaking Ukrainians, but actually he is killing people there. There were 9 corridors, humanitarian corridors, that tried to get out people. They are just starting to finish right now, so we don't know how many people left today the territories of bombardment, but we hope that there would be not less than the previous days. Already the humanitarian corridors allowed over 100,000 of Ukrainians to leave the territories of bombardment, and it actually means that these humanitarian corridors save their lives.
And Julia,
one of the worst situations is different in the occupied south of Ukraine, because people really are on the verge of humanitarian crisis, and they have huge food shortages. This is the region which is named Kherson region. It is fully occupied by Russian authorities. There were also fights, but we didn't hear about any casualties in the south. Kyiv looks like a fortress. I am in Kyiv right now. So we hope it's quiet today, thanks God. One of the first days when it's quiet, but we don't know what to expect.
And just
we
quickly,
see that, just quickly, Yulia,
sorry to interrupt, but just quickly, you've worked closely with President Zelensky. He's seeking direct negotiations with Vladimir Putin, who's so far refusing. What would President Zelensky be taking to the table to try to end this?
President Zelensky tried to make Vladimir Putin to talk directly, and we understand that the position...
The sound of New Zealand. Whitebaiting at the Mōkō River, Taranaki.
Christchurch, this is Today FM News.
Good morning, I'm Carly Flynn at 7. Calls for the government to scrap some COVID-19 mandates are getting louder. Cabinet will meet this afternoon to discuss measures. New Zealand First Leader Winston Peters told Tova O'Brien they've been in place for too long.
When we didn't have the utilities that we've got now, they made sense, but they've long since lost the sense of the logic to them, and we should have moved on.
And hordes of businesses are praying the COVID requirements will be eased. Newmarket Business Association Chief Executive Mark Knopf Thomas says it's time for orange.
The business community are chomping at the bit to get back to business. A lot of places have suffered severely. We've had numerous closures across Auckland and I'm sure around the rest of the country.
Mark Knopf Thomas says vaccine passes also need to be looked at. The lawyer of a Russian anti-war journalist is worried his client's mental health is deteriorating. Marina Ozyanikova was fined for holding a sign on live TV protesting the Ukraine invasion. She could still be jailed, and lawyer Anton Kaczynski told Tova O'Brien she's stressed. His words are translated.
She's also concerned about her children, especially her oldest son. He is not fully supporting of her actions.
You can catch the full exclusive interview with Tova shortly. Meanwhile, the US believes Beijing is open to providing Russia with military and financial assistance. Democracy Project's Jeffrey Miller told Rachel Smalley tensions are high.
The problem for Xi and from the Chinese perspective is if Putin fails, that will trigger unrest in Russia, and these sanctions probably already will.
A wet and stormy morning for people in the North Island. Many are waking up to thunderstorms and heavy rain. Fire and Emergency has received multiple calls of flooding in Moriwa in the far north. In sport, Kiwi driver Scott McLaughlin's right in the mix in the latest IndyCar race, the Texas 375. He's leading at the halfway stage with fellow Kiwi Scott Dixon's fourth. Meantime, Ferrari's blitz the Bahrain Formula One Grand Prix. Charles Leclerc has won, with teammate Carlos Sainz finishing second.
Let's go! Let's go! Come on! That's exactly how we should start a season. 1-2, baby! Yeah!
Excitement there. Motorsport with Carter's Tyre Service, experts in performance. And a 35-0 win over the Blues has seen Chiefs Manawa win the inaugural Super Rugby Aupiki title. Captain Les Alder says her team's done a wonderful job.
For us to have had the opportunity to play in a critical year for women's rugby in New Zealand, we're really grateful for that.
I'm Carly Flynn from the Today FM News Network, news that moves us forward.
With the Big Red Value Cars Warehouse, Hagley End of Moorhouse, Value Cars Warehouse.
Today FM traffic.
Accurate traffic with Ray White.
A cloudy day ahead around the Garden City. We're in for a high of 20 degrees. And coming into town right now, it's all pretty quiet out there on the roading network. We're not seeing any delays at this stage. We'll let you know when they do start to build towards peak hour. Just a heads up that coming up on Wednesday night after 8 p.m, the Waimate River Bridge is closed city bound. You'll have to detour via the old bridge, but it remains open heading northbound.
Proudly local, proudly family owned, proudly Ray White. RayWhite.co.nz.
With Tree Tech, providing expert professional tree services for 25 years.
Well, it's a mostly cloudy day in the Garden City today. Some drizzle possibly in the morning and then rain or drizzle from the afternoon. Nor'easterlies about as well. It'll be a warm one though, 20 degrees the high.
Morning, New Zealand.
It's Tova on Today FM.
Love that song. Morena Aotearoa. This is Today FM. I'm Tova O'Brien. That's Mark Dye. And we are so glad you're joining us today. It is 7:04 a.m. Cabinet today will discuss the future of vaccine mandates and any changes to the traffic light system. It comes at a time when Omicron is at its peak and hospitals are being stretched to the core. For more on what we might expect, we're joined by the Health Minister, Andrew Little. Morena, Minister. Is the health system in crisis? Have we got Andrew Little standing very by? There's been much debate, I think, but we do. We do have Health Minister Andrew Little. Can you hear us?
I can hear you loud and clear.
Fab. Is the health system in crisis, Minister?
It's certainly under pressure, and we knew this would happen because, as with other health systems around the world, when Omicron hit, we knew that there'd be big escalation in the number of patients going to hospital We knew that there'd be increased staff absenteeism. That's what's happening in our health system at the moment, at least the hospital system, and that was what was planned for at the end of last year.
Reports in Newsroom last week that there are just four vacant staffed ICU beds. That sounds like a crisis to me.
Except that it's not correct.
How so?
Well, it's not correct. We have about 280-odd ICU and high-dependency unit beds available, currently about 180 utilised. Throughout the Omicron pandemic, our ICU capacity across New Zealand has been at about 60 to 62%.
And those are staffed ICU beds?
Yes.
And if restrictions are lifted now, the mandates, the passes, the gathering limits, will COVID hospitalisations go up?
Well, the modelling shows no. And right now what we're seeing, particularly in Auckland, is that the hospitalisation rates are stabilising, possibly on their way down. They'll continue to rise throughout the rest of the country, probably for the next week or so, and then they will sort of start tapering off as well. So we think we're at the point of this outbreak where the pressure will start to come off the hospital system.
So you would support then mandates being lifted, vaccine passes going? You're confident that it's not going to have any additional strains on, place any additional strains on the health system?
Well, two things. Well, Cabinet will discuss those issues today, but secondly, we will need some sort of measures, at the very least, things like masks in some situations for a time to come yet, keeping distances, those sorts of things. But we'll go through the current rules, what we think is justified. We've always got to be conscious of knowing the nature and the state of the infection now and the kind of restrictions that are on people, what can be justified. So that's the sort of debate that Cabinet will have today.
And this was always going to happen after we peaked, but how can we be confident that we have peaked if people, you know, they're not testing because they don't want to know that they've got it, or they're not reporting tests?
Yeah, so we always thought that when we get those numbers every day, we think it's a fraction of the numbers. It's probably, you know, one in three or one in four, maybe one in five. That's why we look at the hospitalisation rate, because people who do get really sick with Omicron will go to hospital. We're seeing those numbers have gone up quite a bit, but they're starting to plateau and starting to come down actually in Auckland. So the measure for us has always been the hospitalisation.
So we're going to see unvaccinated health workforce return to our hospitals and the health front line shortly?
The unvaccinated health workforce, well, not quite sure about that. I mean, one of the issues about the vaccine mandates is we have to see, will they continue to be justified in any situation? So that's part of the debate today.
Right, so it could be that we don't have a blanket lifting of restrictions. The mandates remain in health, for example, to protect that strained workforce and to protect vulnerable New Zealanders going into hospitals and the like.
Yeah, and that certainly remains an option, yes.
Okay, do you want Ardern to slow down, Jacinda Ardern to slow down on this move?
Look, I think it's about looking at what's happening with the infection, looking at the measures that are in place, looking at the impact that's having on people, and getting the balance right. In the end, I think the way we've approached this all the way along is to keep as many people as possible safe, and it's about keeping, as to the best extent we can, the pressure off the health system. I think, you know, the health system and our health workers are under immense pressure at the moment. I totally acknowledge that. We haven't had the absolutely kind of overwhelming situation that we saw in other countries when they hit their peak Omicron. That's been uppermost in our minds, keeping the pressure off the frontline health system.
And perhaps also weighing up what is politically palatable and what is not. Thank you very much, Andrew Little, our health minister. It's 7:08 a.m. Carly's now in with the headlines.
Today FM headlines.
Thank you, Tova. The Rescue Coordination Centre is leading a significant operation off North Cape. Five people have been rescued from a vessel after a radio beacon was activated last night. We'll bring you more as it comes to hand. New Zealand First wants some COVID mandates scrapped over concerns they're outdated. Cabinet is meeting this afternoon to discuss measures. Leader Winston Peters told Tova O'Brien they initially made sense, but it's time they were axed. And the White House says President Joe Biden has no plans to visit Ukraine. He's heading to Europe this week for snap emergency summits on the invasion and Russia's growing attacks on civilians. PureSouthShop.com, delivering New Zealand's finest red meat straight to your door. And more news as soon as it happens on Today FM.
Thanks, Carly. It's 7:09. Listening to that interview with the Health Minister was National Leader Christopher Luxon, who joins me in the studio now, the first politician I think I've seen in about 3 months or something. Thank you for joining us, Christopher.
Hey, well, great to be with you, and congratulations on the new show. I'm sure you're going to be a big success. Are you enjoying it?
Thoroughly. Oh, yeah. I'm going to enjoy this bit too. Tell us that you've been calling for those restrictions to be scrapped. What if it means that our hospitals do end up overrun? It's all very well for the minister to be saying that the modelling doesn't show that, but we know that the modelling is not always accurate.
Right. Yeah, well, look, I mean, our message has been pretty simple. Look, is that, you know, fundamentally the country's ready to get back to some normalcy again. And, you know, what we're saying is today you could actually get rid of vaccine passes. You could get rid of, you know, vaccine mandates for under 18s. You could certainly look at sort of 5-day isolation periods. And I think ultimately, you know, vaccine, you know, mandates and vaccine passes have actually run the course. The utility in Omicron is quite different, right?
What about this idea that you could keep mandates in place for the, as the Health Minister just said, keep them in place for the health workforce, for example? Would you support that?
Yeah, look, I think we would, because essentially come April 13, we're going to have all these Australians coming in. Vaccine passes aren't going to make a lot of sense at that point, and you'd progressively start to unwind the vaccine mandates. I think the health workers is the last one that you're left with, to be honest.
And you've been kind of talking about this for a while now, actually since the protest, but it wasn't that long ago that you were so heave-ho on mandates that you actually wanted sanctions on beneficiaries, sole parents who didn't vaccinate their children. Do you still want that, sanctions on beneficiaries who don't vaccinate their kids?
No, I think what you're confusing is the day I was selected as a candidate, I was on about measles. As I said at the time, like, I completely misread our policy on that, and I was brand new, made a mistake, apologise for that.
Okay, and would you go back to cutting benefits of, this was part of that same discussion document that you sorry misspoke on, but would you go back to cutting benefits of mothers who won't name the father of their children?
No.
You wouldn't? And what about cutting benefits at all?
No. Look, we're very supportive of that. What we've really got to focus on at the moment is this cost of living crisis, and we've got to work out how we're going to help support people through that. I mean, this is something that's going to be the major issue. Omicron, we're going to go up the peak and we're going to come down the other side. There's going to be progressive removing of those restrictions, as there should be. The government, I think, has been way too slow and a bit too reactive to the public, to the media, to the opposition. And essentially we're in a place, once we come through the other side, we're back into the biggest issue, which is going to be cost of living and economics.
You said in your State of the Nation speech that your mother taught you that we all have a responsibility to support those doing it tough. Low-income earners are doing it tough, doing it seriously tough. You point this out a lot yourself. So why aren't you prioritising them with your tax cuts?
Well, look, all we're saying, very simple, and it's not actually tax. What we're saying is, you know, we have a tax thresholds in place, right, in terms of as you earn money, you progress to get taxed at different rates. As you get more money, you get taxed at greater rates. And essentially, we're saying is you can either leave that for years and years and years, but it becomes irrelevant. In the last 4 years, we've had 11.5% inflation. Why don't we just pump those tax thresholds up? Because you're actually capturing...
Sure, but why scrap the top tax bracket? Why do you want to benefit the loaded people, the wealthy end of town rather than the low and middle income earners?
Yeah, look, there's two parts to what we're proposing. What we're saying is, look, Grant Robertson's going to load up with another $6 billion of new money. There's going to be a 68% increase in government spending. Of that $6 billion, we're saying, Grant, why don't you take $1.7 billion of it, give it back to the New Zealand people with tax-adjusted, inflation-adjusted tax thresholds, and that means that you're not inadvertently catching an average income earner here in New Zealand on $72,000 at 33% tax rate.
I'm a minimum wage
person at 30% tax rate. So if you don't sort of pump those up now, when would you do it?
I'm no economist, but is giving people more money really the best way to deal with inflation?
There's no difference in inflation. Grant Robertson's already driving a big part of domestic inflation with his government spending. The OECD is saying to New Zealand, hey, listen, rein it in. If you don't start doing that shortly, there's going to be a bigger set of problems in 12 months and 24 months' time. We've been saying that for months as well.
But then scrapping all taxes, you cut into that core ground revenue.
But we're not. No, we're just stick with the proposal, which is very simply saying he's loaded up and he's been spending like nothing, addicted to spending the last 4 years, right? He's now getting $6 billion of brand new money to add in on top of all of that to go forward with, and that gets baked into baseline for the next 4 years. So keep adding more and more money. What we're saying is just take a piece of it, and we trust the New Zealand public to spend that money or to save that money much better than Grant Robertson spending it on some program that won't come through and deliver for New Zealand people. So for us, it's a very simple thing. It's common sense. It's practical. It happens all around the world. Otherwise, you just wouldn't adjust your tax bands for 30 years or 20 years. If you can't do it now, why wouldn't you do it?
Do you need a tax cut?
Who, me, personally?
Yeah, you.
No.
You're getting the biggest one. And inadvertently, yeah. I'd be getting the biggest one as well. Yeah, I don't need a tax cut.
But let me remind you what's happened. So we've had major increases in minimum wage, gone up 6% this year, gone up 36% in the last 4 years. Think about the 3% of New Zealanders that pay 1/4 of all of our tax. 10% of New Zealanders pay half of all of our tax. So if you just think about all the public services, that's what's coming, where it's coming from.
We didn't get an answer from Winston Peters. He hung up. Last word to you. Yeah. Do you think Winston Peters is going to stand in the Tauranga by-election, yes or no?
I've got no idea. I mean, that man is a mercurial. He's a rule unto himself. But we'll be ready for him, put it that way.
Thank you very much for your time. National Party leader Christopher Luxon, thanks for coming in. It is 7:14. Pai Korero, our panel is next. And our first ever guests are former Prime Ministers Helen Clark and Sir John Key. They join us after this.
The name's Burr, Lloyd Burr, live after 4 on Today FM.
Driveways, patios and paths, three things Affordable Concrete specialise in. For advice and an obligation-free quote, visit affordableconcrete.co.nz. Concrete and paving specialists.
Kitchen Things End of Financial Year sale is on now. Huge savings on a wide range of ovens, cooktops, range hoods, dishwashers, fridges and laundry. Over $10 million worth of premium brands currently in stock. Don't miss our End of Financial Year sale. Shop kitchenthings.co.nz.
Introducing the Woodsman Carnacu Ultra Low Emission Wood Burner, the latest addition to Woodsman's hugely successful range. Hi, Mike from Four Seasons. Woodsman Carnacu is perfect to heat 2 to 3 bedroom homes. And don't miss the special intro price of only $2,099 for the fire, including a 4.2 metre heat saver flue system. And at Four Seasons, we offer free installation quotes. So warm your home this winter with the new Woodsman Carnacu. Only $2,099 from Four Seasons Tower Junction.
Water spots on shower glass. They're a nightmare to clean. Rubbing and scrubbing, and you can still see them. They never completely disappear until now. Vitriglaze can remove water spots from your glass shower. Vitriglaze can clean back your shower glass, removing all water spots, making your glass shower look brand new again. And the Vitriglaze protective coating will ensure water spots don't come back. No more water spots with Vitriglaze. Call 0800 48 48 76.
We work hard all our lives, and when we retire, we want to do it on our own terms. Generate can help. Generate is a New Zealand-owned and operated KiwiSaver provider. Join Generate and Lloyd Burr Wednesdays at 6:40 for the Investment Business Blog. Kiwis helping Kiwis retire the way they want to. Generate, the KiwiSaver specialist. To see a copy of Generate's product disclosure statement, head to generatekiwisaver.co.nz/PDS. The issuer is Generate Investment Management Limited.
Facts, context, understanding.
Tova, with Generate, make a smart decision with your KiwiSaver savings. On Today FM.
It is 7:17 in the morning.
How long have you been on the radio for? 45 minutes? You've already pissed off Winston Peters.
I think I keep him in a state of perennial pissed offness. Such has been our relationship. I feel more sorry for our poor producer, Tom, who immediately got a call from Winston Peters having a go.
So for anybody that wasn't listening just before 7, what was the question you asked him that annoyed him?
Just whether he's standing in the Tauranga by-election or not. Fairly obvious question, something a lot of people want to know. Winston did not want to talk about it.
No, and he left us, and he's now, placing angry phone calls to our producers. A couple of texts and people loving having you on the radio.
Oh, thanks,
guys. Saying welcome to Radio Land, which is really, really lovely. What's happening now?
I'm excited about this. I'm very excited about this. Time now for Pai Korero. This is our panel. We're going to do this every single day. And welcome to our very first panel, a very esteemed first panel indeed. We are thrilled to have with us not one, but two former Prime Ministers, Helen Clark and Sir John Key. Kia ora korua.
Pai Korero with Tova on Today FM.
I'll leave this on. Yep.
Have I got you, Helen Clark? Have I got you, Sir John?
I think so. I can certainly see you and I can see Helen.
Great. Great. We're off to a rip snorting start. It feels like 2008.
Yeah, it certainly does. I'm going to turn my other backup phone off, I think, because otherwise I'm going to hear myself the whole way through.
Oh, yeah. I think I was hearing that echo as well. Ironing out the kinks is today with ironing out the kinks casually with a couple of prime ministers.
As you do.
Helen Clark, if I could start with you, is it time for the mandates to go? Are we prepared enough?
Are we prepared enough? Who knows? I think the thinking seems to be that so many people are vaccinated, which is obviously a huge number, and then take into account those who have had the virus as well. They're calculating that there's not much for it to spread around. So, here we are.
And Sir John Key, Christopher Luxon, I mean, the man models himself after you, even his mannerisms are a little bit Keyesque. Do you think he's choosing the right fights so far and is scrapping that top tax bracket, tax cuts for the rich, the right kind of perception thing for the National Party at the minute?
Oh, absolutely. I think he's picking the right fights, and it's not for me to judge that. It's for the public, and they're doing that through the political polls where they're showing, you know, he's the first leader from National for a long time to get traction over Labor. And look, I mean, you know, the tax cut argument that he's talking about, yeah, you can always pick on the highest taxpayer gets the highest, you know, tax cut, if you like. But the reality is that they also pay the most tax. I mean, what he's trying to do is say New Zealanders deserve to keep more of what they earn. And actually, this government, as we know, is wasting one hell of a lot of money. So aren't you a better judge of spending your own money than Grant Robinson, who seems to throw it around like a drunken sailor?
Helen Clark, I'm going to let you defend that defamation suit on behalf of Grant Robinson.
Well, unfortunately, the pandemic's meant that governments have had to run debt levels that, you know, in the past we would have really had nightmares about. I mean, clearly at some point you need to start to, you know, move the back towards a better fiscal balance. But if I look back over the last 2 years, I think there'd be not only a lot of families but also a lot of businesses who'd be, you know, pretty pleased that Grant Robertson opened the checkbook.
And Helen, if we can move on to Ukraine, do you think there's any chance, maybe after this NATO summit, but do you think there's any chance of a no-fly zone being imposed at all during the course of this war? Is there a point that we could get to that would trigger that no-fly zone response that President Volodymyr Zelensky is asking for?
Well, the problem is, if you have a new no-fly zone, you've got to enforce it. Mm. And so, okay, NATO declares it. They send the planes up to try to intercept Russian planes, then it's all on between two nuclear blocks. That's the problem. That's the nightmare that NATO is staring down the barrel of. So I still don't think that's very likely. I just don't think it's likely because of the concern that you make this into World War III. And while World War II and World War I were horrific enough, World War III with nuclear weapons is another order.
Yeah, the first time a no-fly zone would be imposed on a nuclear superpower, which is a terrifying thought. So, John, what about Ukrainian refugees? Could we be doing more in New Zealand in terms of helping with the family reunification, but could we be doing more in terms of quota allocations or extensions, emergency extensions, to bring in Ukrainian refugees now when the need is so high?
Look, obviously, technically, possibly, yes. I mean, we take a number every year. My day, it was 150, I think it was similar in your day, Helen, under the UNHCR program. That's increased a little bit recently. I think you can increase that in theory, or you can say, the UN don't love this, by the way, but you can say, look, I'm going to take people under that category, even though I'm, you know, in theory, the UN would prefer that they had the selection capability. Second issue is you can take a separate grouping. We did that with Syrian refugees. The only thing I'd sort of say, I think good on the government for allowing family members here in New Zealand to have their family come in. Outside of the Russians, I don't think there'd be a single person on the planet who hasn't had their hearts go out to the Ukrainians and also had tremendous respect for them, actually. I think they've proven themselves to be fiercely independent and courageous, and you can't help but want to see them win and succeed and do well, not just because Putin's quite a nasty individual doing awful things to the Ukrainian people, but because they just represent themselves with great pride. The only issue I'd say, though, is that, you know, if there is a solution sorted out here effectively, and that would be ultimately have to be a negotiated one, I think, whether we like it or not, through diplomacy, I'd say the vast bulk of Ukrainian refugees will want to go home. That's the sense I get. I mean, they seem to love Ukraine and want to be there.
Even as a temporary safe haven. I'm keen to get your thoughts on this after these headlines as well. We're with our panel after the headlines, Helen Clark and Sir John Key.
Thanks, Carly.
Today FM headlines.
A massive rescue operation is underway at the top of the North Island. A radio beacon was activated by a vessel off the coast of North Cape at about 8 last night, with 5 people rescued so far. Helicopters are searching from the air and vessels are supporting the operation as well. Cabinet will meet to discuss mandates and traffic light settings today. Winston Peters is joining the chorus of those calling for COVID-19 measures to end. The White House says President Joe Biden has no plans to visit Ukraine. He's heading to Europe this week for snap emergency summits on the invasion and Russia's growing attacks on civilians. And it's a wet and wild day for Northland and Auckland. Severe thunderstorm and heavy rain warnings are in place. PureSouthShop.com delivering New Zealand's finest red meat straight to your door. More news as soon as it happens on Today FM.
Good morning. It's 7:25 a.m. And we're back with our panel, Helen Clark and Sir John Key. Thank you both again for being with us. Helen, what do you think about that idea? I'm interested in what Sir John was saying about the Syrian refugee intake, that emergency allocation. Should we be doing the same now? And should we have maybe been doing it, you know, a few weeks ago?
Yes, you can do that. And I'm just thinking of precedents going back to Jenny Shipley and the Kosovo refugees at the end of the 1990s. So there's a case for doing it where you have just this sudden explosion of refugees. Afghanistan last year is another case. John's right, you can fit quite a number of people into the normal annual allocation. That's probably been in a bit of suspension to some extent over the last 2 years as well because of the pandemic. But whatever, I agree with John, but apart from, you know, the hearts in the Kremlin, which are pretty stone cold, most people in the world are just looking at the plight of Ukrainians and thinking, good grief, you know, if I was in that situation, wouldn't I get in a train and try to go? So, of course, people want to help. But I agree also, they want to go home. They're fighting for their homeland. But, you know, depending on how long it goes on, they might get home or they might not.
Could I get, just to kind of to wrap, but could I just get a quick thought from each of you, your best idea to help curb the skyrocketing cost of living? What can be done urgently, even temporarily, to help those on low and middle incomes, especially beyond the measures that the government's already taken? So, John, you first, please.
Look, honestly, I think two things. One, you have to resolve some of these logistics issues. So you frankly got to get people back to work, because some part of what's really driving inflation here is that. Mm-hmm. And secondly, I think it's signalling from the government. I know people will say, well, that's cute. But, you know, what's happening is, and Helen's right, you know, when you're in a crisis, you have to throw money at it. We did it in the Christchurch earthquakes. You know, every prime minister's had a situation where they've had to do it. I get that. But there's just no getting away from the fact that the government's overprimed the pump and the Reserve Bank is having to raise interest rates. And at ANZ, where I'm chairman, we're talking about 250-point rate hikes coming forward. That's going to take more money out of the pockets of New Zealanders than anything else. If the street could see that the government was going to be a bit more responsible with its spending, the Reserve Bank wouldn't raise rates as much and inflation would cool off a little bit. And, you know, that takes some discipline, and Bill English had a lot of that. And honestly, I think, you know, it's great saying that the government had this big COVID fund and it threw it all at COVID, but it didn't. It spent it on every wish list it had. So I think they've got to sharpen up.
This is not a very – I asked for a quick answer. Your one best idea. Helen Clark, what is yours, bearing in mind that Sir John Key has taken up a fair chunk of your time?
Well, I think in banking circles, and John obviously is chair of an important bank board, there is concern that the Reserve Bank has run a loose monetary policy for longer than it should have. So there's a bit of food for thought in there. Otherwise, I suppose in the short term, the government's done what it could with the petrol price and the public transport and I think the annual benefit adjustment. But it's not easy. It's not easy. And yes, we need the supply chains working. We need people back at work. But a lot of them are not sort of one wave of the wand solutions, are they?
No, not at all. Just quickly, since we've got the both of you on the phone, I'm just wondering, do you guys have each other's numbers in your phones? Do you text each other often at all, or is this a rarity?
Oh, it's way closer than that.
Used to call it the Rolodex.
Back in 2008.
Of the Kiwi for Kiwi Foundation. Uh-huh. We've been raising money together to save the Kiwi. We went on a little outing together out in the countryside to release Kiwi in the helicopter. We are very close. You would be quite surprised, actually.
It's unbelievably
cute. There we go.
Cute.
That is cute.
Thank you very much to our cute former Prime Ministers, John Key and Helen Clark. Really, we're trying to get you guys to come in on the regular, so I'm hoping that's the case. Off to a rip-snorting start. Thank you very much for joining us.
If they're saving the Kiwi together, then they can join us, you know, every couple of weeks, I'm sure.
It is now 7:29 and Carly is here with the headlines.
Today FM weather check.
Well, it's a mostly cloudy day in the Garden City today. Some drizzle possibly in the morning and then rain or drizzle from the afternoon. Nor'easterlies about as well. It'll be a warm one though, 20 degrees the high.
Today FM traffic.
The Mito Automotive Apprentice, your smartest investment yet.
A cloudy day ahead around Christchurch, the high 20 degrees. And coming into town, traffic hasn't really built up on the roads at this stage. It's all looking pretty quiet for now across the network. A bit of a heads up for anyone using the Waimak River Bridge. Coming up on Wednesday night, it is closed citybound after 8 p.m. And the detour will be via the old bridge. You can still travel northbound though. Those lanes do remain open.
Subsidies available. Visit mito.org.nz/train to find out more. TradeDepot.co.nz.
Get in quick. Trade Depot has lowered the prices just for you on thousands of new bathrooms, kitchen and laundry appliances. 250-litre deep freezers from $350. Front-loader washing machines from $399. Huge French door side-by-side fridge freezers from $999. Hurry into the Sockburn showroom or shop online now at Trade Depot. With minimum spends, get free home delivery in Canterbury. T's and C's apply. TradeDepot.co.nz.
Good regulation costs, but the cost of lives lost on our roads is much higher. That's why we're proposing changes to our fees to help fund better regulation, which means better safety on our roads. This may affect the amount some people pay for services like driver licences, regos, wafts and coughs, and it means everyone will pay their fair share. To find out more about the proposals and have your say by Friday 13th of May, go to nzta.govt.nz/funding-and-fees today.
Hi, I'm Jason, Managing Director at Fowler Homes. In life, everyone does things a little differently. These days, home ownership starts at different ages and stages with different needs and different budgets. It's Fowler Homes' mission to make a dream new build a real choice for all homeowners. Got questions? We've got answers. Find your local team at fowlerhomes.co.nz.
Your style of living.
Your style of builder.
At Nurse Maud, we know that health complaints and physical challenges can prevent us from enjoying all that life has to offer. Fortunately, our health and mobility shop at 285 Wairakei Road has everything from wheelchairs and walking frames to clothing protection and continence supplies. Alternatively, if you'd prefer to shop from the comfort of home, you can visit us at mauds-online.co.nz. Nurse Maud, helping you maintain your independence.
Safe, secure, and right here in Christchurch. Safe deposit boxes are back. Commonwealth Vault has now recommissioned the vault in the historic public trust building on Oxford Terrace, securing more than 10,000 household customers. Keep your valuables safe, off-site, and away from your home in a state-of-the-art facility. Visit commonwealthvault.co.nz for more information. Commonwealth Vault, securing your valuables for a lifetime and beyond.
A new start, a new day.
Tova O'Brien and Mark Dye with Generate, the KiwiSaver specialist. Learn about your KiwiSaver options today on Today FM.
Morena, I'm Tova O'Brien.
Good morning.
And that's Mark Dye. Thank you to Generate, the KiwiSaver specialist. They were voted as the best KiwiSaver service in the Quality Service Awards in 2022. That was in the superannuation category. It's 7:33 a.m. Russian journalist Marina Ovsyannikova stunned many around the world when she broke onto a state-run live news broadcast in an extraordinary demonstration against Russia's invasion of Ukraine. She was given a relatively light sentence, fined $400 after a gruel link 14-hour interrogation by Russian authorities. But what her ultimate fate will be is far less clear. Last night, I spoke with her lawyer, Anton Gashinsky, about Marina's case. His words have been translated by our producer, Tamara Azizan. Maybe you could just start by telling us, how is Marina? Where is she?
Марина на сегодняшний момент находится в безопасности.
She is in a safe. Наконец-то. She managed to return home finally.
Своей семье.
To rejoin her family and her children.
Состояние у нее достаточно сложное.
So her mental health is not quite well. She's worried. She's very stressed. She's also concerned about her children, especially her oldest son. He is not fully supporting of her actions. And I believe he's 17 years old, just about to turn 18. He'll be turning 18 this year.
Wow, that's incredibly tough, having gone through all of that, and then the public scrutiny, I imagine, as well. Mm. And maybe just her eldest son not agreeing with her actions. What does he think of her protest and why?
So his, you know, he lived his normal life. He's 17. He had a normal life. You know, he had a confidence in the future. Everything was stable. Mom had a job and a good salary, could be considered middle class. You know, she had some debts, but she had, you know, always had work. And suddenly it's all flipped upside down. Mom has under criminal investigation, potentially criminal charges, she's not working. There's debts and credits. There's uncertainty. It's very worrying to him, and it could be extra sanctions placed on his mom, just his mom, and he's afraid that she may lose the house or the apartment, you know, the place where they live. So there's a lot of that's yet to come, and he's very worried about that.
Did she maybe not so much about her son at this stage, but was she prepared to take that risk, and how big was the risk that she took?
She mentioned this now a few times, how she felt personally. He's just relaying her personal thoughts as she relayed to Anton, that it was building up over time, her, you know, sort of dissatisfaction with what her work and the messages and what was happening. And then it sort of reached that final point where she decided to take action. And it went without problems because she didn't tell anyone what she was doing. And she managed to go past security. No one stopped her. So she succeeded in her mission. And yeah, because she didn't tell anyone. It was her own personal decision to act like that.
Yeah, and I wonder about that as well with Marina. So far, a fine. She was detained, questioned for 14 hours, denied access to you, her lawyer. Do you expect that there will be further repercussions, and are there fears for her safety?
So what we saw, that fine of 30,000 rubles, that's relating to her pre-recorded video message, which was, you know, sanctioning people, inciting people for unauthorized protests. But her protesting, her action on live TV, during that's yet to be, it's still under investigation and under review. So no criminal proceedings have been initiated against her, but it's still under review. So of course she's very concerned about her safety, because there's still, if she faces criminal proceedings and criminal charges, like felony charges, then she might be jailed, and her sentencing will probably be unmatching to her act, will be exaggerated and strict. And but she's a Russian patriot, she loves Russia, she's a real Russian woman. There's a saying as a poem that Anton's quoting, that a Russian woman can stop a galloping horse and walk into a burning building, and then she does, and then she'll think about the consequences later. So she responded with you know, action, passionate action, and then now she's realizing the consequences of it.
Does she have any regrets?
So she shared with me that she doesn't regret her action, what she did, and if she would, you know, had an opportunity to turn back time, she'd do the same thing again.
Well, we hope that she is a woman that can stop that galloping horse, and I know that New Zealand, a lot of people here support her, so please pass that on. Thank you very much, Anton.
Oh, thank you very much. I will pass everything to her.
Tova O'Brien.
Today. That was Anton Gushinsky, the lawyer of Marina Ovzianikova, who Piers Morgan has called the world's bravest woman. It's 7:39 a.m. and we have some breaking news now.
This is Today FM breaking news.
Severe weather has caused an incident up north. We've got reporter Delphine Herbert with us. Delphine, what can you tell us what's happened?
Yeah, so this is unfolding as we speak. So an emergency beacon went off around 8 p.m. last night. So it's happening in East Cape, just off the coast of East Cape. Five people have been rescued so far, but police have just told me that a number of people are unaccounted for. Mm. Now, as you know, like, bad weather is really hampering the top of the country, especially around that Northland Whangarei area. A number of severe thunderstorm warnings are in place. There's heavy rain, so this is obviously making the operation a lot harder. But to give you the nitty-gritty details, so the rescue is still active. Helicopters are kind of assisting. There are also vessels in the water kind of helping to figure out what's happening. But yes, five people rescued, a number of people unaccounted for.
Any advice from police or emergency services about what people should be doing in these severe weather conditions?
Yeah, look, I have been speaking with Met Service this morning. You know, they're just warning to basically take cover and
hunker down.
Be prepared for some crazy weather. A forecaster did tell me this morning that they're expecting some places, especially in the north, in the Whangarei area, are expecting 12 millimetres of rain in a 12-hour period.
Wow.
And he told me that that is very a significant amount of rain for that period of time. So, yeah, pretty scary situation, especially, you know, with it being so dark outside at the moment still as well.
Dark and severe weather conditions. Thank you very much, Delphine Herbert, our Today FM journalist. We'll go now to Carly with the headlines.
Today FM headlines.
Well, thanks there. As you just heard, five people have been rescued in a massive search operation at the top of the North Island. A radio beacon was activated by a vessel off the coast of North Cape at about 8 last night. We'll bring you more as it comes to hand. Winston Peters is joining the chorus of those calling for COVID-19 measures to end. The New Zealand First Leader supported the Parliament protest calling for mandates to be axed, and Cabinet will meet to discuss the measures today. And in sport, Kiwi drivers Scott Dixon and Scott McLaughlin are looking good in this morning's IndyCar race. With just under 70 laps to go, Dixon's third and McLaughlin is fourth. PureSouthShop.com delivering New Zealand's finest red meat straight to your door. More news as soon as it happens on Today FM.
Tova's $5,000 question.
One question, 10 seconds, $5,000.
I've got goosebumps. Let's give away $5,000.
I've got the envelope. I've got the envelope with the question in it.
We've got so it's a sealed envelope. It's got a question. We know it's politics related. We know the theme, but that is all we know. That's all we've got to go on. Politics. How good's you've got great political knowledge.
Ooh, I can remember what's happened recently. It depends. If it's like from politics from 1976, then probably not so good.
Oh, that's going to be good for our debate club later on then when we're discussing politics from 1979. More to come on that later. If you want to play this morning, give us a call. 0800 Today FM. That's 0800 863 2936. That's next, but first.
I think it's a real issue.
Tova.
First Tova. Some more Tova for you.
I mean, we're working our way through this.
Exactly. This is one of those creases that we were talking about before.
I love all the people just saying my name in new, weird and wonderful ways.
I know. Well, again, welcome to radio. You get to give away $5,000 cash. 0800 Today FM if you were wanting to answer that question. In the meantime.
Yeah, we are doing something a little bit different here. We've asked Te Reo Māori lecturer Hear Me Kelly to give us a kupu of the week. So we're going to do a Māori word of the week so we can build our reo. Kia ora Hear Me, how much will this help us with the language?
I think it's a real achievable way to include more Te Reo into your conversation, your interactions with each other and with other people. And then hopefully what it does is it shows other people that they can do the same thing, listeners out there, that they can do the same thing. We've seen what it's done with words like mahi and aroha. You know, those are words that have become known because we use them all the time when we're speaking English.
Yeah, I kind of credit Shortland Street for a lot of that. I feel like Shortland Street was the one that led the way for me. I don't know, maybe I just watched too much Shortland Street, I'm not sure, but I feel like words like mahi, I feel like the writers of Shortland Street did a wonderful job with. So hopefully we can help. So what is our kupu of the week?
The kupu of the week, well, for language to be useful, it has to be relevant. So I think to start off, this would be a good word, and the word is take. Take.
Take.
Take. Take. Take is, you guys are going to be talking about a lot of important take, you know, throughout the week. So every now and then you can use this word instead of the word issue.
Ah, nice. We're going to have so many take on our show.
What's plural?
Be take, wouldn't it?
Well, that's the thing. So when it comes to using Māori words in English, we're not going to add the S, but you're going to talk about a lot of different take. So we still use the word take, whether it's singular or plural.
So it's like sheep, kind of, in English, isn't it? Sheep is plural.
Yeah,
yes?
That's a good example.
Good, okay. And T-A-K-E for those at home wanting to spell?
Yeah, T-A-K-E, short and sharp. There's no macrons on any of the vowels, so we don't need to lengthen either of those vowel sounds. Short and sharp, take.
Thank you very much,
Ralph. What's the take at hand?
What's the take at hand? Thank you very much for our first scoop of the week, Hemi. Really appreciate your time, and we'll talk to you again next week.
Kia ora kōrua. See you next week.
Tova's $5,000 question.
One question. 10 seconds. $5,000.
The smile on your face is incredible. It's like you're getting the $5,000 yourself.
I'm getting. I actually just love that sting. I love the prospect of giving away 5K, but I also just love that sting.
And we are doing this every single day at this time. So if you'd like $5,000, just be listening today to today at around this time. Yep. And $5,000.
Call us first on 0800 today FM. Do we have someone on the line? Okay, we should also let you know, because Mark and I really want to give this 5K away. We are desperate to give it away. The questions are completely gettable, but we're going to be adjudicated by Jeremy, our producer, Jay Payne, who is actually, he rules with an iron fist. And if you don't get this in 10 seconds, what's gonna happen, Jeremy? No go.
Well, someone argue that I'm a real heartbreaker. And on a Monday, on our very first show, which, congratulations, guys, going very well, I really don't want that to happen today. So let's see what happens. Hopefully,
wants to make love.
Let's make love, not war. And
I'm a lover, not a fighter. And Grant on the phone. How are you going today, Grant?
Yeah, very good, thanks.
Yes, great. Are you fired up, Grant, about the prospect of going home $5,000 or hanging up the phone $5,000 richer?
The heart rate's starting to climb pretty high. And congratulations, Tova. Nice to hear you on the air finally.
Thank you. Thank you for being on the line with us. My heart rate is going like the clappers as well. I can assure you of that.
Age-old question, what would you do with the money?
I've got lots of jobs around the house. My wife would probably spend it before I did. But
how are you? We know that the theme is politics. How are you with politics, Grant?
Well, I'm a dedicated follower of politics, but doesn't mean I'm going to get this right.
Okay, well, let's give it a go. Are you ready?
Yep.
We'll take your first answer only. You've got to complete your answer before the time is up. You've got 10 seconds. Let's do this.
Open it up.
Who was the Speaker of the New Zealand House of Representatives before Trevor Mallard?
David Carter. David.
Grant, is that your final answer?
Has to be.
It has to be.
Sorry, Grant.
You're not getting a second chance. What happened to make love,
mate? I just want to be a game show host. All right.
And rules.
Grant, are you confident of your answer?
I can picture him in my head, and I'm pretty sure his name is David, but I'm not sure about the Carter.
All right. The answer is... That's me doing a drum roll. Can't do a drum roll.
It's an actual drum roll.
Jeremy's got an actual drum roll for me. Yes! David Carter it is! $5,000 is yours, Grant.
Sorry, I'm just looking at Carol's face. Did you not think it was David Carter? Carol's
Grant,
like,
How do you feel?
Oh, that's amazing. I can't believe it. First time I've ever won any money on anything. But
you're going to make me cry.
Is the wife listening to the radio right now?
No, she's on...
Okay, so there's maybe a chance that you can keep this a secret so you can spend some of the money yourself.
Terrible advice. Play this for your wife as soon as she gets home. Thank you so much, Grant. We are just chuffed, absolutely chuffed to have been able to give you $5,000 this morning. Well done.
Thank you. It was a good move ditching Hoskins this morning, wasn't it?
No comment. Couldn't possibly comment. Thanks again, Grant. Congratulations. It is 7:48 a.m.
I want to get in on the Love Fest this morning, guys. That's fantastic. I was sure he was wrong.
Scan your club card to unlock these great deals this week at New World. Heineken 330ml 24-pack bottles for only $42.99 each. And Mudhouse Wine Range 750ml now just $12.99 each. Now that's New World value. Sizes limit exclusions apply.
I'd love to buy my first home.
What's the pre-approval?
And when do I need to get one? How much deposit do I need?
Chat to ASB's first home team to answer questions like these, plus the ones you haven't thought of yet. ASB, let's talk. ASB Bank Limited's lending criteria and terms apply.
Stop surviving with varicose veins and start living. Talk to the vascular experts at Christchurch Vein Clinic. They can treat most symptoms of varicose veins, meaning you get back to the life you dream about. Plus, Christchurch Vein Clinic are a Southern Cross affiliated provider, so their treatments are covered by most health insurance policies too. What are you waiting for? Stop surviving and start living today. Visit christchurchveinclinic.co.nz.
Did you know with a Supergold card, you can stretch your money further every day? Businesses throughout New Zealand offer savings and special offers to Supergold cardholders on fuel, food, health costs and more. To find out what's available, visit the Supergold website at supergold.govt.nz. Or you can download and check the Supergold app on your smartphone or tablet. Don't miss out. Start turning your everyday essentials into Supergold today.
At Commonwealth Vault, they value things that stand the test of time, like gold, silver, and other precious investments, and the buildings that safeguard them. That's why Commonwealth Vault sells bullion and stores bullion at the historic Custom House Building in Auckland, completed in 1890, and the historic Public Trust Building on Oxford Terrace in Christchurch, standing tall since 1925. CommonwealthVault.co.nz, New Zealand's premier vault provider.
Automation, anything that needs repairing, residential and commercial. Dominator Doors. Dominator Doors. .co.nz. Need a garage door? They are specialists.
Dominator Christchurch, Cranford Street.
How does all this affect you?
Unpack the day's stories with Duncan Garner.
Duncan Garner today.
With DBS.
This morning, after Tova from 9.
On Today FM.
Good morning. It is 7:51 a.m. The mood, I mean, the mood was already pretty high in the studio, but mood has lifted even more after giving away all of the money.
I'm so glad we got
to get in amongst all that Love Fest, guys. Sorry, I'm sitting in my own little quiet booth here. And oh my goodness, I thought he was wrong, and then he was right.
I don't think you were the only one that thought he was wrong.
He's mixed his Davids. He's put somebody's,
I had no idea.
What I'm going to do is to lend context so that you can all see that Carly kind of sits in a little dungeon separately from us. I'm going to take a photo and chuck that up on my Twitter at Tova O'Brien shortly so you can see the lay of the land from where I'm sitting in the studio. Have we had any feedback?
We have. Hello, first-time listener, enjoying the show. Congrats, Tova. Awesome lineup for the first show. Of course, if you do want to text us, 3920 is the number. We'd love to hear where you are, how you're listening, if you're enjoying it, if there are any issues, given this is the first day of us broadcasting around the country. if there's something weird happening, let us know so we can fix it for you.
Yeah, and let us know what you'd spend your $5,000 on as well. I'm musing over that.
Yeah, totally. And of course, another chance to win tomorrow. $5,000 up for grabs tomorrow and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday. It'd be interesting to see how long the boss lets us run with that one.
Do you know when I got my first ever pay packet from my newspaper stand when I was a kid? Because we kind of lived in a sugar-free household. I spent my entire, I think it was $30
you kind
my monthly.
Of lived in a sugar-free household?
I lived in a sugar-free household. And my entire, I think I earned maybe $30 that month for my newspaper stand outside the railway station, and I spent the entire thing on Gobstoppers and Cocoa Pops.
Do you know what's funny? You mentioned papers, though, because this morning when the alarm went off, I actually weirdly got thrown back in time to when I used to deliver the Herald, because I think up until
did you deliver
morning,
the Herald?
Up until this morning, I think that was the earliest I'd ever actually voluntarily woken up for work, I guess.
Yeah. Both of our first breaks into the media industry, selling newspapers. I was selling the Dominion Post, the New Zealand Herald.
The Herald.
So bipartisan of us not picking sides, not picking cities, that represents our show here on Today FM.
Debate Club.
Oh, yes. This is another exciting segment that we're going to be doing just after 8 o'clock. You guys choose a moot, something for me and Mark to argue over. We'll flip a coin. One of us will have to argue the affirmative. One of us will have to argue the negative. We're often going to get into a position, I think, where we're arguing for things that we don't necessarily agree in.
I think that is going to be the challenge, is that we're relatively aligned. I mean, we haven't known each other forever, but we're relatively aligned. So, yeah, each morning during Debate Club, one of us is going to get the raw end of the deal and have to argue, I guess, for something that we don't really believe.
So text us with any ideas that you've got. 3920, if you want us to debate them. We'll put them into a little kitty and pull them out as the weeks wear on, and then we'll tally up the winner. But this is another segment that I'm really excited about on Tova. Later this morning, just joking. In the interest of giving our audience the facts straight up, we've gone to the extreme of hiring our very own fact checker.
Here comes the fact checker. That's his specialist, daddy up. Checking all the facts for you. He's checking the facts.
It's the Today FM fact checker.
And he's not just a pretty song, he's also a massive brain. You too can put questions to our fact checker. Just email us on tova@todayfm.co.nz and we'll put him on the case. His first assignment has been to check out what the truth is on vaccine mandates. We've been talking about it a lot this morning with all of the pollies. Social media is alight with the claim that we're the last place on earth to have mandates. So, is this the case?
Vaccine mandates, the central idea of the protest at Parliament, the divided topic all over your social media newsfeed.
Shame on you! Shame on you!
So, should we be going up to our hospital? People like you shouldn't be allowed.
But are they still necessary? If you look online, many commentators will say New Zealand is one of the last places on the globe holding on to the mandates. But is this really true? Many countries like the US, France, Australia and the UK still require you to be vaccinated to travel there. However, for citizens of many nations, the picture looks a little bit different. Austria suspended its mandate for over 18s a day before it was due to begin a week ago. The UK went one step further, lifting all vaccine mandates and COVID restrictions.
Might still make the difference between keeping businesses open at full capacity or not.
Meanwhile, Germany was considering a nationwide mandate by the end of the month, but it failed to gain support in its parliament. However, some countries are holding fire despite mounting public opposition. In Canada, the majority of the provincial mandates no longer exist, but the federal ones do. They still cover a number of businesses in both the public and private sectors.
You know what helps lift restrictions? You know what helps move beyond lockdowns? Vaccinations.
But back to New Zealand. Where do we stand?
When we remove them, it will be because it's safe to do so on behalf of all New Zealanders.
Many of the world's developed countries still have some kind of vaccine mandate in place, but few are as strict as New Zealand's.
It's the Today FM Fact Checker.
Fact Checker.
Fact Checker.
Fact Checker. Fact Checker. Fact Checker. And we are getting our Fact Checker, Tom, on the line right now so that we can talk through with him how this is going to work. So will he solicit questions? What's he going to look into? Has he had, I think he's had a few suggestions already. And Tom Day is on the line. Tom, are you with us?
Morena, how are we, team?
Morena, Tom. Great, thank you very much, and thank you for checking the facts for us. What else are you going to be looking into?
Yeah, my inbox has already been flooded. I put out a tweet last week, and the people have come calling. And so we're going to be looking into a really interesting set of issues. We're going to be looking at how much more mild is Omicron than Delta.
You've got first-hand experience on that as well.
I do. I'm currently isolating. So, yeah, we're nearing the end of that period. We're also going to be looking into young people. Are young people just lazy and sitting on the couch instead of getting to work? And we're also going to be taking a look a little bit later.
Who asked that to be fact-checked?
Yeah, so a few things going on.
Brilliant. Well, we look forward to it. We look forward to it, Tom.
And of course, it doesn't just have to be a generic idea or an idea that you've come across somewhere else in the world. If you hear something on Today FM that you're like, that sounds a little bit rough,
Maybe shall we rewind the Winston Peters interview and maybe you guys could get some inspo?
Yeah. If you hear something that one of the hosts says, even Tova or I, it doesn't matter. Just say, hey, I want that fact checked, and we'll send it off to the fact checker.
Yeah, absolutely. Keep us in check as well with the fact checker. Thank you so much, Tom. Thank you for joining us. And thank you for your first fact checking. After the break, we're going to do Debate Club, and we have had some ideas coming in. It's looking like, so we talked about this a bit before. We are shaping up to do a debate around Carless Days. Bring back Carless Days is the moot. Yeah. So all Carless Days, introduced by the Muldoon government back in 1979 to try and tackle, like, the skyrocketing petrol prices. Mm-hmm. Similar case today.
And should we bring them back? Who do you think should argue for? Who do you think should argue against? Give us a text now. Tova against. 3920. This is Today FM. Thanks for joining us. News is next.
Good morning, I'm Carly Flynn at 8. A massive rescue operation is underway at the top of the North Island. As Delphine Herbert reports, a number of people are unaccounted for.
A radio beacon was activated by a vessel off the coast of North Cape about 8 last night, with 5 people rescued so far. Helicopters are searching from the air and vessels are supporting the operation as well. Maritime New Zealand says it's challenging due to the weather conditions and poor visibility.
As little as 20% of people are thought to be reporting their positive COVID-19 results. Officials are deciding the next steps today, with Omicron thought to be past its peak. Health Minister Andrew Little told Tova O'Brien hospitalisations are the best indicator as people get complacent with rat reporting.
We think it's a fraction of the numbers. It's probably 1 in 3 or 1 in 4, maybe 1 in 5.
Winston Peters is throwing his support behind anti-mandate protesters as he joins the chorus calling for COVID measures to end. The New Zealand First Leader spoke with people during demonstrations in Wellington and told Tova O'Brien they're being marginalised.
The mass majority were normally decent people. I saw business people, lawyers, doctors, all sorts of people that were there. And to image them as that, I think it's just shameful.
The Ukrainian president's former press secretary says a different type of threat is facing the south of the country. An art school in Mariupol has come under fire by Russian forces, with 400 people thought to be inside. Yulia Mendel told Tova O'Brien that despite fewer missiles falling, the area is not in the clear.
People really are on the verge of humanitarian crisis and they have huge food shortages.
Met Service is warning of severe thunderstorms for parts of northern Auckland. This includes Kaipara, Rodney and Albany. In sport, Kiwi driver Scott McLaughlin's just been pipped in the second Indy car race of the season. An exceptional last lap from Josef Newgarden saw him overtake McLaughlin on the last corner of the Texas 375 to win the race. Scott Dixon finished fifth. Motorsport with Carter's Tyre Service, experts in performance. Our women's cricketers are struggling to come to grip. Their World Cup semi-final hopes are more than likely over. All-rounder Amy Satherwaite admits they're not in an ideal position after yesterday's one wicket loss to England.
Pretty gut-wrenching to get that close and not quite get over the line and feel like you were standing on the edge of the cliff, borderline out of the competition.
Cricket with GJ Gardner-Holmes get the best of both worlds. And more success for New Zealand athletics, with high jumper Hamish Kerr winning bronze at the World Indoor Champs. I'm Carly Flynn from the Today FM News Network, news that moves us forward.
With Value Cars Warehouse, specialising in late model, low-key cars. Value Cars Warehouse.
Today FM traffic.
Trade me jobs, where New Zealand goes for jobs.
A fair bit of cloud cover sweeping through today around Christchurch with a high of 20. And if you are coming into town, there's just a bit of traffic in those usual spots right now, for example, on Brougham Street through Addington and also Cranford Street coming down past Innes Road. But outside of that, it is fairly quiet across the network. If you are going to be travelling on the Womack River Bridge on Wednesday night, it's actually closed citybound after 8 o'clock.
TGIM. You could also be thankful for Mondays with Trade Me Jobs.
With Tree Tech. The professionals in trees for over 25 years. Tree Tech.
Well, it's a mostly cloudy day in the Garden City today. Some drizzle possibly in the morning and then rain or drizzle from the afternoon. Nor'easterlies about as well. It'll be a warm one though, 20 degrees the high.
Good morning, Aotearoa.
It's Tova.
Live from the Today FM News Centre.
I mean, is it a breakfast radio studio, or are we hitting the clubs illegally under traffic light system red?
Well, I was going to say, this kind of gives you a little bit of a taste of what doing breakfast on the edge is like. out of the 8 o'clock news comes some David Guetta.
Good morning, everybody. This is Today FM. I'm Tova O'Brien. That was Mark Dyer. We are so glad that you're joining us for this today. And we're so glad that you too are joining us, Wilhelmina Shrimpton. The pandemic's taken an immense toll on our communities, and now there's some evidence our inner city streets are being directly impacted. So we're talking to Wilhelmina Shrimpton. She is the host of the podcast series The Core. Wills, you've been looking at this issue closely, but first just tell us a bit more about The Core, what it's about, and what are the topics you're looking into.
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, happy launch day, guys. I'm so happy to be here
Thank you.
Now, The Core, as the name suggests, is literally cutting to the core of topical issues, concerning issues, interesting topics that really spark the interest of Kiwis. And yeah, as the name suggests, we delve deeper than anything that I reckon is out there. Mm. And I know that you, Tova, more than anyone would know the limitations of a very tight and small duration. Oh. So that's what I don't have here. Each episode is about 50 minutes. It's long. We talk to anywhere from 6 to 12 people about these issues and covering every single angle, really getting to the nitty-gritty. And it's been such an interesting experience to really give each issue the justice it really, truly deserves.
And how are you choosing what you look into?
Anything that sparks our interest. It could be something topical in our headlines as part of the news cycle, or even something as weird and kooky and left field as the metaverse and NFTs, which is one we've got coming up in a few weeks' time.
Yeah,
trust me, I probably spent about several hours diving deep into the Google wormhole, the black hole of NFTs in the metaverse. It was very, very interesting. I'm not sure if I even know what they are yet, but...
No,
watch this space.
I think that's it. I don't think anybody really understands, but people are making money, so everyone's diving in.
Exactly.
No, I know that there are people that actually understand. But save the 20 cents. Don't text that.
And this week's episode is you know, it's actually particularly chilling, isn't it? Tell us about it.
Yeah, so this one delves deeper into street safety and the massive increase we've had in street assaults, not on just the public, but businesses and also police as well. We've seen a massive increase as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. The demographics of our city have significantly changed, and that's brought in a lot more opportunists, more criminals. There's a change in the makeup of our backpackers. It's attracting a certain type of clientele into our CBDs, not just Auckland, but Wellington and Christchurch as well. And there's kind of this whole a range of issues that are sort of rolling in together to create this perfect storm of assault. So that's aggression around COVID, the changing demographics, even alcohol and drug issues. This was actually sparked from an incident that happened to me in the level 4 lockdown last year. I was out on a walk, probably a couple of blocks from my house, so normally really familiar and friendly streets. I was stopped by a group of men in a car and pretty much accosted by them. Luckily I wasn't injured, but I was really shaken. You know, I could feel my heartbeat in my ears, and I remember them, they wouldn't let me pass, and I called my husband and got him on the phone just in case something had happened.
Yeah.
And I delved a little deeper and spoke to a lot of people, and they'd actually had a similar experience. And then I looked at the stats backed it up. We've spoken to a whole range of people, police, MPs, businesses, victims. And one of the victims that we actually spoke to, and this was an incident that happened only a few weeks ago, people might know this man, Paul Anderson. He's the brother of JJ Feeney, so one of our More FM hosts. He was injured in an alleged shooting on Fort Lane in Auckland, and he actually sat down with me and rehashed that terrifying moment, and I've got a clip here to play. I know it's going to be hard to relive it and talk about it, but I'm hoping you might be able to take me back to that night.
I tended to run off, but I could barely stand, like, quite wobbly. I made it probably, I don't know, it's about 100 metres, not even that, to Queen Street. Why I was going that way, I'm not sure. Just, I needed out. And I remember turning around to my partner and saying, like, help, I've been shot. And she seen blood everywhere. And I think I took a couple of steps onto Queen Street itself and just collapsed to the ground. Droplets of blood everywhere. So she came running up. My friend Josh, who was there, he came running up. He seen me on the ground. Partner was trying to cover him. She took her top off to put pressure on what we thought was just one major wound. She called the ambulance. They said to put pressure on, but there were so many holes, we didn't really know where to start. I was having hot flushes, like real severe hot flushes, where I felt sick and faint. I was coughing up blood. Yeah, and I just remember, like, thinking about my kids. It was horrible. It was hard.
Well, it's terrifying and visceral, Wills. When can people hear more? I want more. When can people hear more of Paul's interview?
Well, this is actually such a big issue. We actually did two episodes on this. So we've got nearly 2 hours dedicated to this topic. The first episode, it's literally going up online as we speak and will play on air between 7 and 8 p.m. tonight on Today FM. And Paul's interview, the full extended version of it, I spoke to him for nearly half an hour. You can hear that next week, Monday the 28th as well. It'll be up online, but also playing live on air between 7 and 8 p.m. on Monday night.
Thank you so much, Wilhelmina Shrimpton, host of podcast The Core. And we're going to talk to Auckland City Centre Residents Group Chair Anthony Phillips after these headlines from Carly. Take it away.
Today FM headlines.
Thanks, Tova. A number of people are unaccounted for in a rescue operation in the far north. The radio beacon was activated by a vessel off the coast of North Cape at 8 last night. Helicopters and vessels are supporting the operation and 5 people have been located so far. A tree has fallen on Ahuroa Road in Puhoi, north of Auckland, blocking both lanes. Crews are working to remove it. Meanwhile, reports of surface flooding have been received around Western Hills Drive, State Highway 1 and State Highway 10 near Kerikeri. And the Health Minister promises there are plenty of beds available in intensive care units. Andrew Little says reports only 4 or 5 remain vacant are simply not true, with 280-odd remaining. PureSouthShop.com, delivering New Zealand's finest red meat straight to your door. More news as soon as it happens on Today FM.
Thanks, Carly. It's 11 minutes past 8. And following on from Wilhelmina's experience, it's fair to ask the question, are these situations becoming more common? For more, we welcome spokesperson for Auckland City Centre Residents Group, Anthony Phillips. Mōrena, Anthony, thank you for joining us. We've heard Paul's story, part of it there, and it certainly makes you feel like that could happen to any one of us. How do City Centre residents feel?
Mōrena, Tova. I want to congratulate you first on your new show.
Thank you.
CCRG, as we're called, the City Centre Residents Group, we have been advocating for the re-establishment of a downtown police station, which was closed in 2013. I didn't get to hear what Wilhelmina was talking about before, unfortunately, because I was on the phone to your producer. In fact, as we speak, I'm sorry, I hear more of myself than you.
We'll try and get that sorted for you. This really shocked me. I only moved to Auckland in January, and I would have just assumed that there would be a police station in downtown central Auckland. So it was extremely surprising to me to learn that there wasn't one. We've got one down the road from us here on Hargrave Street by Media Works, but it's hardly a kind of capital of crime here. It's more down in the city centre, right?
Well, I think we've got a little bit more going on than we have out in the leafy suburbs of College Hill and Ponsonby.
Oh, right.
I think when in downtown, when we had our own police station, it was about a bricks and mortar police presence, which was visible, and people could drop in and connect with police on a more personal one-on-one way. In 2013, it was cited there was already a police station at the main headquarters, I should say, at Merrill Drive. And so it was argued there was already 2 police stations within the city centre. But now, of course, the headquarters have closed, have moved out to down the road from you. And now the city centre, which is the most densely populated community in the nation of pre-pandemic levels, 65,000 plus, doesn't have their own police presence, a physical police presence.
And aside from the need for a police station, so we've only got about 30 seconds to go, but aside from the need for a police station, is there anything else that can be done urgently to try and make Auckland safer?
Probably when we have more people return to the city centre, when we have more people walking around, tourists, workers back in town, we will see probably a drop in crime, because the only people hanging around largely at night at the moment are the antisocials.
For sure. All right. Hey, thank you so much for your time, Anthony Phillips, from the Auckland City Centre Residents Group. It is 8:13 a.m.
The Debate Club with Tova and Mark.
We have a moot. Is whether or not Carla Stays should be brought back. And
do we have a have we been told which side of the argument we're arguing for and against?
Yeah, I feel like you've won this one.
Yes. Carly Flynn, you're still in your cave. Come join us.
Can I? Okay, I'm looking forward to adjudicating this. Although, remember lockdown when nobody was allowed to drive? Tova, you won't remember the Harbour Bridge. During the first lockdown, it was absolutely silent. There were orcas in the Hauraki Gulf, and there was so much nature around. Kind of like the idea of Carla's Days, but you
Carla's
know.
Weeks from Carly. Yeah. Carla's Carly, we call it. Carla's like months.
Yeah. Ironically, has car in the name, but doesn't want cars at all.
Well, I was looking at my petrol gauge this morning, and I thought, crikey, I only filled up last week.
Yeah, well, there it is a point. It is a point, and a point that Mark's going to get into in far more detail shortly. Yeah. Just shortly before I win.
You wanted to go for against this, Tova, did you? Why?
Because I think they were roundly. This one seemed like an easy
win. So yes, she wanted to go again.
I mean,
that's
it's
why.
Day one. I've got enough on my plate. It's terrifying as it is. So let me win the first debate.
Well, look, the people have texted and they've said that you should go again. So that means I'm up first, arguing that Carla Stays are a good idea, yep. And you're going to be on the negative, saying they're not.
So Mark's, and we'll do it traditionally, like a traditional debate, the affirmative goes first. So Mark will argue in the affirmative, bring back Carla Stays. I'll argue in the negative, do not bring back Carla Stays. And we're going to do that pretty shortly, actually.
Just after the 8:30, I think. Just a note, team, I have a timer that actually works today for your 90 seconds, and I've got a bell.
I saw the bell. Actually, I heard the bell before I saw the bell. All right. So we're gonna be kept to time.
Mm-hmm. I'm gonna be as professional as the three of us can pull this together. Yep. On our first morning on Today FM.
The height of professionalism. Thank you very much. We've got 30 odd minutes, I suppose, now to develop our arguments, and we'll present them to you at 8:45. It is now 8:16. We better get cracking.
What on earth has happened to our city streets?
Attacks, shootings, crime like never before.
This week, we investigate street safety in our biggest cities. On the Core with Wilhelmina Shrimpton.
Unit circuit. This will be in that Merc and that firearm prescribed as a pistol.
There's a black Mercedes down there, sir.
Yep. Comms ATS priority.
Streaming now on Rover or wherever you get your podcasts.
Brought to you by Today FM.
Case of the Monday blues? Yep, we get it. After all, it's now been 4 days since your last Burger Thursday, and there are still 3 days till the next one. But don't despair. There's nothing stopping you from slapping a mouth-watering beef patty in a bun, along with a few choice salad leaves, and pretending today is Thursday. Whatever gets you through. So go on, treat yourself to a Burger Thursday, even on a Monday. We won't tell.
There's a burger for everyone, a Burger Thursday.
Head to burgerthursday.co.nz to find your favourite any day of the week.
House and land packages have been harder to find than a cheap cauliflower. But great news. Today, homes have secured sections in popular Rolleston and Horswell. They can build your dream design or select from one of the many Today Homes plans. These home and land packages are selling fast, so don't muck around. Talk to one of the good guys at Today Homes. Catch them at one of their four stunning Rolleston show homes or pick up the phone. Locations, opening hours and contact details all at todayhomes.co.nz. Making home building easy for 34 years. Today Homes.
Somerset at Avonhead and Somerset at Wigram are taking exclusive private appointments each week this month, and we'd love to see you. Take a guided tour around our stunning villages and serviced apartments. These spacious apartments offer open plan living, a separate double bedroom, and packages to suit your needs. Spaces are limited, so RSVP your private appointment by calling the sales manager on 0800 Summer.
Support your health and well-being in 30 seconds with Nutrient Rescue. Our New Zealand grown whole food powders are almost exclusively organic, with nothing added, and are made to be taken in one daily shot. From only $2 per day, the double shot contains four serves of nutrient-rich fruit and veggies. Start filling your body with goodness. Go to nutrientrescue.nz. Supplementary 2 and not a replacement for a balanced diet.
Facts. Context. Understanding.
Tova. With Generate. Make a smart decision with your KiwiSaver savings. On Today FM.
You can get in touch with us and please do email tova@todayfm.co.nz, call 0800 todayfm or text 3920. Have we had many people getting in touch?
We have. Thanks so much for that. Linda says, loving the show. If I won the $5,000, I'd buy 2 massage chairs for my husband and I to relax in whilst listening to your vibrant, interesting show.
Aww, thank you, Linda. Call tomorrow.
Somebody says, hey, Tova, you should do a segment called Let's Blindside Winnie. You can get him to talk about politics and then when he's on the air, ask him random questions that he's not prepped for.
I'm not convinced we're getting Winston Peters back on the show in
you
Ari.
Reckon? No, he's been through worse.
He'll be fine.
Hi, Tova, says Frank. 6 out of 10 so far. Not sure whether that's a positive or a negative, Frank, but anyway.
It's a pass.
Enjoyed your interview with Winston. Funny about the Tauranga by-election.
Thank you very much. It is 8:19. Now,
Today FM.
Someone who's close to the government's decision-making around COVID-19 as an advisor to the Prime Minister because of his close ties with business and corporate worlds is former Air New Zealand CEO Rob Fyfe. He's optimistic about the future post-Omicron, but says he's had some optimism knocked out of him as well.
As a business person, I mean, you love to, you have a plan, you think of scenarios and so on. The challenge with COVID is we keep having things happen that are unexpected. You know, when we were planning our vaccine rollout, which we were clearly slow on in hindsight, we didn't plan knowing that Delta was coming along. If we'd known that, we maybe would have been motivated to go a whole lot faster. Omicron has actually, we've managed, I think, Omicron really well. We're in such a highly vaccinated state. There seems to be 2 waves of Omicron. There's a BA1 variant wave, and now lots of countries are experiencing a BA2 wave. Looks like we almost missed the BA1 wave. Most of our cases are BA2. Mm-hmm. So I kind of look at that and think, actually, that's real positive, but I'm still a little fearful. The epidemiologists say, I hear people say, you know, the next variant will be less virulent than this one. The epidemiologists say that's not necessarily true. So don't leap to that conclusion. We still could get something really serious.
After the kind of initial delays around the border reopening, it's now been brought forward again. Could it and should it have come sooner, especially to those non-visa waiver countries like China and India, who still, tourists from those countries still have to wait until October?
Well, in the case of China, I don't think that really matters. I mean, it's so restrictive going back in that direction to get into China that I think that route's going to struggle for quite some time. I think practically the challenge is that for those countries that require visas, our ability to process an influx of those visas it will be limited.
Yeah. How much of a blow is that China, you talk about those kind of the restrictions down the line from the China side. How problematic is that for us, given it's our, you know, biggest trading partner, second largest tourism industry?
I think those issues are but one of many, many issues that are starting to loom with China. You know, my fear is that the world is in danger of breaking into 2 very distinct halves, you know, one centred around USA and Europe and one centred around China and maybe China and Russia. And it causes me some angst, to be honest, that we have such an important trading relationship with China and that fracture is becoming wider and wider between China and USA. Mm. So I think this issue of the physical access into markets is going to be a smaller issue than that, larger problem.
And I know you're worried about some of the divisions that we're starting to see, or that we're seeing in New Zealand, we're seeing all around the world. There was I think you'd be hard-pressed to find someone who condemned the government's COVID response in the early days, and it was really unifying, as you've pointed out. Do you think, how do we get past that division? I mean, it was writ large at Parliament during the protest, like horrifying scenes. How do we get past that division and start reunifying as a country?
Yeah, I think it's the challenge, if you like, of our generation. You know, I've got this very strongly held view that social media creates division for a start. So we live in a world where whatever we believe is then reinforced to us through our social media feeds, because all the algorithms are designed to serve you up the stuff you believe in. So if you're anti-vaxxer, you see everything about anti-vax. If you're a pro-vaxxer, you see everything about pro-vax. And I think society is becoming divided through those mechanisms. So we're almost swimming against the tide. But, you know, as you say, I look back at the first 12 months, thought COVID, you know, we were unified against this great adversary. Now we're all incredibly fatigued. And when you get tired, you get scratchy and you get argumentative and so on. And I feel us getting, as a country, getting more argumentative. I listen to media commentators that are taking very, very polarised views. I think for us to get a sense of unity back, we need to galvanise behind a vision and an aspiration of what we want New Zealand to be out the other side. And I think that's the opportunity for actually both the government and the opposition, is to paint a picture of the future that brings New Zealanders back together and then helps to find a pathway towards that future. And that's the challenge for government today.
Couldn't agree more. And it was a very, it was the answer of a statesman. And I know that you've said in the past, who'd want to be a politician, making the point that you're kind of damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. But it is on trend for former Air New Zealand CEOs to go and run for Parliament. So is this on the cards for Rob Fyfe?
This is never on the cards for Rob Fyfe. And to be fair, when I finished at Air New Zealand, the question was asked of me, and it had a one-word answer, and that was no.
We'll see. Former Air New Zealand CEO Rob Fyfe. It's 8:25. Carly's in with the headlines.
Today FM headlines.
A number of people are unaccounted for in a rescue operation in the far north. The radio beacon was activated by a vessel off the coast of North Cape at 8 last night. Helicopters and vessels are supporting the operation. 5 people have been located so far. Cabinet will meet to discuss mandates and traffic light settings today. Winston Peters is joining the chorus of those calling for COVID-19 measures to end. A watchful eye is being kept on China over its response to the war in Ukraine. The US has information suggesting it's open to providing Russia with military and financial assistance. And Met Service is warning of severe thunderstorms for parts of northern Auckland, including Kaipara, Rodney and Albany, expected to be accompanied by very heavy rain. PureSouthShop.com, delivering New Zealand's finest red meat straight to your door. More news as soon as it happens on Today FM.
Thanks, Carly. It's 8:26. If you'd asked me 6 months ago if I would be standing here in this radio studio, living in a city that doesn't even have a parliament, doing a job that I never thought I could do for a radio station that didn't even exist, I would have told you, you're dreaming, mate. But when you're given a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to be part of something as special as we're creating here at Today FM, you close your eyes and you take the leap. And this something special is all yours. Today FM is yours. We're here to listen, to talk to people, the people that you want to talk to hear ideas, solutions, reflections that interest you. We will be fierce and fearless when it comes to calling out injustice, but we'll be empathetic and kind when you need a shoulder. And we'll take your stories to people who can make the changes to make things right. Here on our show, Tova, we'll share our opinions and views, but we're open to yours. We're not here to judge or take sides. We want to debate, and we're not afraid to admit when we've got it wrong, when we've changed our minds, or when we just can't quite decide. We will be curious and courageous. We'll be honest, starting with the fact, full disclosure, that I have absolutely no idea what I'm doing. 1 week ago, the studio felt foreign, confusing, and frankly terrifying, and it still is all of those things, but I'm having a great time learning, and I'm glad that you're here with me to help. 6 months ago, the team who put the show together for you were strangers. We've only worked together for 5 days, but we've already been through a lot and fast become family, and collectively, we are committed to you. 6 months ago, I could not have imagined this moment. Now that I'm standing here, I can't imagine anywhere I would rather be. It is 8:28, still to come, the Debate Club, and we chat to Duncan Garner next.
Today FM Weather Check.
Well, it's a mostly cloudy day in the Garden City today. Some drizzle possibly in the morning and then rain or drizzle from the afternoon. Nor'easterlies about as well. It'll be a warm one though, 20 degrees the high.
Today FM traffic. with Avon City Ford.
A cloudy day ahead around Christchurch in for a high of 20. And if you're coming into the city by Brougham Street, it is slow through Addington again, so expect delays there. Elsewhere, though, the network is pretty quiet. 15 minutes down from Belfast to town on Cranford Street. Just over that, if you're coming in from the airport via Fendleton Road. If you're making your journey up Colombo Street, it's a pretty good run all the way through from Cashmere Road for now.
Test drive the new Ford Puma at Avon City Ford at the Sockburn Roundabout.
Kevlar Homes has your interests at heart and believe you deserve full confidence and peace of mind when building a new home. That's why they provide fixed price contracts. Kevlarhomes.co.nz.
With Vodafone, get broadband made for New Zealand business, where you'll experience great value no matter your business size and a tailor-made solution that's right for your business. Just search Vodafone Business Broadband. Broadband not available everywhere. Terms apply.
What if you could book free power to use at a time that suits you? Genesis customers can, with free power to use however and whenever they like with PowerShout. Eligibility criteria and T's and C's apply. Genesis, with you, for you.
Bob, I'm so pleased you're embracing our ski lifestyle.
Ski? We don't ski.
No, ski. Spending the kids' inheritance at Christchurch RV's new mega centre.
Well, they do have everything we need to make our caravan trips away even more comfortable.
You mean like that satellite dish you've got your eye on?
And the bigger awning you want.
Well, let's go then. We definitely need to pick up more loo chemicals. So while we're there, maybe...
A Christchurch RV centre. Very easy to find at 801 Jones Road, Rolleston. James
Bull. Lock up your place. James Bull. Lock it with James Bull.
No one gets past James Bull.
Keep your home safe with an electronic deadbolt from James Bull. Find the right fit for your home with their wide range of electronic deadbolts. With the ability to give one-off codes to service people, see your options at jamesbull.co.nz. James Bull Locksmiths, unlocking solutions in Canterbury for over 80 years.
Our strength is your security, James Bull.
Noel Leeming's epic entertainment deals are on now. Epic deals on TVs, audio, headphones, gaming and heaps more. Plus, take the hassle away with our delivery and installation service. And get 30 months interest-free store-wide. Conditions apply. Available at Noel Leeming.
There's so much you can do to make your outdoor space your own. Your personality, your touch, your creativity, all of that. There's so much range. There's so much that you can do. There's so many different ideas that you can like bring to life.
Fern screen panel, $99. Rustic fire pit, $139. Mini Tough Landscape Plants, $7.
Where you find a competitor's lower price on the same stocked item available for same day delivery or collection will beat it by 15%. Conditions apply. See website for details. Lowest prices are just the beginning.
A new start, a new day.
Tova O'Brien and Mark Dye with Generate, the KiwiSaver specialist. Learn about your KiwiSaver options today on Today FM.
It's 8:31. The Russia-Ukraine war is also having an effect off the planet. Russia's announced it will start work on its own Mars fleet after a joint European project was suspended because of the Ukraine invasion. Meanwhile, our own rocket man, Peter Beck, founder of Rocket Lab, is pushing on with a plan to get to Mars to build a much bigger spacecraft. Peter, I want to start by talking about the Neutron, the big rocket you said you would never build, the rocket capable of human spaceflight. Why are you doing this?
Yeah, well, I mean, it started off with, Electron, our current rocket's been hugely successful, and a lot of the customers that fly on that, we flew a lot of their early prototypes for their large constellations. And they basically come back to us and said, you know, Pete, this is great, but we really need a much larger rocket to deploy our constellations at scale. So it became really, really obvious that that Neutron was a very, very, you know, needed product in the launch vehicle industry. And then, you know, unfortunately, with the current state of the world's affairs, about at least 50% of all that medium-class launch has just disappeared overnight. So Neutron was very much in demand, prior to some pretty significant world events, but now it's really an incredibly important, product when we get it developed to, you know, maintain access to space.
And it puts you in direct competition, doesn't it, with Elon Musk and SpaceX? And I think Elon had a gentle dig at you when you announced Neutron. What's your relationship like with him?
I've known Elon for quite some time, and you know, he's a tremendously talented and incredible guy, and generally, you know, fairly supportive. Elon told me once, Pete, you need to go and build a bigger rocket. So there's a good relationship there, and the space industry is a bit weird because we're all kind of competitor mates. We all rely on each other in a lot of cases for various components because it's such a small industry. So it's one of the great things about the space industry is we can be violently competitive, but also at the end of the day, be hugely respectful of everybody's accomplishments.
Which is also such an important part of what you often talk about, the democratisation of space, right?
Mm.
Having more people up there, not just global superpowers, started by Russia with Sputnik back in 1957, followed by the United States. I wonder what you think then, given the situation on Earth at the minute, what kind of bearing the war in Ukraine could have on the democratization of space and the space wars.
Yeah, look, it's really sad actually, because space throughout a whole lot of global conflict has always remained untouched. It's always the thing that everybody just goes, yep, there's some stuff going on in the ground, but space is always, that area that we always collaborate. And really, for the first time I've ever seen in my life, you've seen that kind of shift. I mean, thank goodness there's still the International Space Station and everything's hunky-dory up there. But, you've seen some pretty amazing stuff especially on the Soyuz launch vehicle. And there's quite a lot of, Russian componentry like rocket engines that are used in Western rockets. And all of that has just stopped. It's a really crazy point in really space history. That collaboration is really, really strained at this point in time.
And this could mark a further shift, do you think?
Yeah, I think the thing to watch out is if this International Space Station starts to get a bit shaky on that collaboration, then I think that's really the last true kind of collaboration and ambassadorship between the two countries. Well, not just the two countries, but the global world with respect to the space. But you've already seen, stop supplying of engines into Western rockets. You've seen Soyuz being pulled from the European Space Agency. You've seen Soyuz kicked off all of the OneWeb satellites. This just stuff is crazy. Like, this doesn't happen in the space industry.
Mm. Your Neutron's being built in Virginia, right, and will be launched from there. Why can't you do it here in New Zealand?
Yeah, I mean, it's been built from a full-scale perspective in Virginia because it's actually been built beside the launch pad because it's so big you can't really transport it. But a lot of the, there's a whole bunch of design work occurring in New Zealand as well. So it's not just a US project, it's a cross-company project. Launching it out of New Zealand would be great, but I mean, it's hard to give people a sense of scale. Like, if you took all the liquid oxygen in the entire country, you half fill the tank. So,
that lends some perspective.
Industrial base. Yeah, it's just not the industrial base in New Zealand to even fly it once. So, it really requires that sense of scale that only the US can offer us at this point.
It's 8:37. More from Rocket Lab CEO after the headlines from Carly.
Today FM headlines.
A massive rescue operation is underway at the top of the North Island. A radio beacon was activated by a vessel off the coast of North Cape at about 8 last night, with 5 people rescued so far. There are calls for vaccine passes to be ditched as businesses struggle to stay afloat. Traffic light settings and mandates are to be discussed by Cabinet this afternoon. Auckland's Newmarket Business Association says they've done their dash and a move to orange is needed. And the Health Minister promises there are plenty of beds available in intensive care units. Andrew Little says reports only 4 or 5 remain vacant are simply not true, with 280 odd remaining. And in sport, so close yet so far for Scott McLaughlin in this morning's IndyCar race. He was overtaken on the last corner by teammate Josef Newgarden to finish second in the Texas 375. PureSouthShop.com, delivering New Zealand's finest red meat straight to your door. More news as soon as it happens on Today FM.
Thanks, Carly. Rocket Lab CEO Peter Beck is on the show this morning. What's the number one thing, perhaps the low-hanging fruit, that the government could do to support your industry, Peter?
Well, I think actually just laying out a really clear strategy. If we look at Australia, they've laid out a very, very clear strategy about exactly what the country's going to do, targeted some investment, and it's super obvious where the country's going. New Zealand doesn't have a space strategy, and I think that's a good place to start. Let's get it on the table. Let's decide, you know, what are we going to be, what is New Zealand going to stand for in space, and what are the programs that we're going to pursue. There's a tremendous amount of international collaborations possible, not just between other space agencies, but other companies and organisations. So there's a lot of stuff to be done.
And with your Rutherford engine, it's remarkable, really, isn't it? With 3D printing, you're able to print one of those things every 24 hours. And I wonder, is there anything else that you're passionate about? Because if you can build something as complex as that every 24 hours, perhaps could you divest some of your time into the housing crisis, maybe knock out a casual 100,000 Kiwi built homes for us? It feels like you could get things cracking.
Well, I'm hampered just like everybody else. I'm just trying to build a shed at the moment, you're trying to try and buy rebar like for a shed. So yeah, no, I mean I'm not sure construction is my bag, but I'll stick to deep tech.
Given how short life is, will we see you on one of those early flights on Neutron in 2024?
No, I'm a nervous flyer. I'm that guy who sits in an aircraft and looks out the window and is calculating the safety factor of the wing and the gas turbine, compressor blades and all that sort of stuff's running through my head. So sitting on a rocket, I think you'd have to knock me out, because sometimes if you know too much, like it's not a pleasant thing. I'd much rather, get on something like that and know absolutely nothing and just smile.
Do you think you'll ever get to space in your lifetime?
I don't know. A couple of whiskies. Yeah. I mean, I know that some people, that's like a really huge, thing and a real strong ambition. I've never had that strong ambition to do that. I'm much more excited on the ground. Working with the machines and designing the stuff, that's what gives me real real excitement. Less so when sitting on one.
Final question for one of the world's greatest entrepreneurs and one of our national treasures. Do you, Peter Beck, believe in aliens?
So statistically speaking, I think it's highly probable that there is other forms of life. I mean, if you look at the universe and we've discovered enough exoplanets that are Earth-like, that statistically speaking, I think life is probably pretty resilient, so there will be other forms of life. The scientist part of me, we have not proven that. So until you have irrefutable scientific evidence, you have to, at this point, assume that we are the only life in the universe. And that's a bit of an arrogant way to think about it, but, scientifically, that's true. This is actually something, I'm deeply passionate about. And we have a private mission to Venus in 2023 to try and answer this question. It's a tremendous long shot. It's like the ultimate of long shots. But, we kind of, if you have your own rocket and you have your own spacecraft that's capable of going to Venus to search for life in the clouds, I figured it would be rude not to. So managed to convince the board to give me a rocket and a spacecraft, and we're going to Venus with a probe to probe the atmosphere. There's a really sweet zone in Venus's atmosphere at about 50 kilometres altitude where it's temperate enough, and this is where the recent discovery of phosphine was made. So we're going to go into that band with a probe, and with one, we're only going in there with one instrument. And it's an instrument to try and detect organic forms of life.
Rocket Lab CEO Peter Beck, thank you. It is 8:42. Next, we're joined by Duncan Garner, who's going to tell us a little bit about what he's got on his show and debate club, arguments for and against carless days.
At Bunnings Trade, we have tax time value on the brands you can bank on. Like a Bosch Blue 18-volt brushless 6-piece kit for just $869 excluding GST. Bunnings Trade. Helping business is our trade.
We're separating. How can I make sure my business is secure?
We've separated. How do we split everything evenly?
These are difficult and emotional times. If you're also going through the stress of separation, Linwood Law can help. They offer a skilled and dedicated service for resolving relationship property matters, whether by negotiation or through the courts. If you're concerned about your situation, please telephone Gerry on 389 2121 or visit the website linwoodlaw.co.nz for more information. Linwood Law, a lifetime of support.
NZI has been insuring Kiwi businesses for over 160 years.
Today, nearly 300,000 New Zealanders choose NZI to protect what matters most to them. Have the right team behind you. Talk to your broker about insuring with NZI.
Protect the ones you love so they can keep doing what they love. With Omicron cases spreading in our communities, now's the time to get your school-aged tamariki immunised against COVID-19. As a parent, you're likely to have questions about the vaccine and what it could mean for your whānau. We're here to help you get the answers and information you need. Call 0800 282 926 to chat with someone who can help or to make a booking for your whānau.
Did you know with a Supergold card you can stretch your money further every day? Businesses throughout New Zealand offer savings and special offers to Supergold cardholders on fuel, food, health costs and more. To find out what's available, visit the Supergold website at supergold.govt.nz, or you can download and check the Supergold app on your smartphone or tablet. Don't miss out. Start turning your everyday essentials into Supergold today.
House and land packages have been harder to find than a cheap cauliflower. But great news. Today, homes have secured sections in popular Rolleston and Hallswell. They can build your dream design or select from one of the many Today Homes plans. These home and land packages are selling fast, so don't muck around. Talk to one of the good guys at Today Homes. Catch them at one of their four stunning Rolleston show homes or pick up the phone. Locations, opening hours and contact details all at todayhomes.co.nz. Making home building easy for 34 years. Today Homes.
When you're sleeping, Rachel's prepping.
No more. With First Light and Rachel Smalley.
Tomorrow morning from 5 on Today FM.
It's 8.45 today. I'm Tova O'Brien with Mark Dye, who is the greatest New Zealander of all time. It is time to settle it once and for all with Today FM's greatest New Zealander of all time, thanks to Rosine. Voting starts next Monday at todayfm.co.nz. Get a quality finish with Rosine paints, colours, wallpapers and helpful expert advice, helping Kiwis decorate their homes since 1946. Tell us who you think the greatest New Zealander of all time is. I mean, Duncan Garner's obviously up there.
How up there? Is it top 10?
Oh, I'd say top 5, easy.
People will decide.
Yeah. Yes, I don't think so.
When we wrap at 9 o'clock this morning, Duncan's taken over and he is in the studio with us now. Duncan, who have you got on your show?
Grant Robertson will join us just after 9.40 this morning. Obviously, Finance Minister, Deputy Prime Minister, mm-hmm. on his way to Cabinet. Cost of living.
Fair amount on his plate.
Yeah, there is a lot on his plate. How can he say that you can't give tax cuts because they are inflationary? But he can go and spend another $6 billion, what you were talking about this morning with Christopher Luxon. $6 billion extra in one budget. Remember the days where they had no extra money?
I know.
And they've got $6 billion bucks.
But billions are the new millions. I think fast forward 20 years, we'll be talking about trillions of dollars.
Here's the entrepreneur.
But it's true. Nobody buys or sells anything for millions of millions of dollars anymore.
The operating spending of budgets just been going up and up and up and up, and every time it was like double it, treble it. It was, you know, kind of eye-watering
Who
stuff.
Wants a tax cut? Who wants a tax cut when we've spent so much and have to pay it back?
And that's my point as well, is that I guess we've got to pay for all this infrastructure somehow. We do actually have to.
I just like the day-to-day expenses to come down, to be honest. My grocery bill, my petrol bill, my power bill, you know.
But have you seen what you buy all this new age stuff?
But
that's
me.
What I say. Yes,
I do not.
Get rid of all that.
Is this toilet paper delivery? That's what it is.
Hey, it's a buck a roll. I bet you can't find it cheaper than that in the supermarket.
Organic fruit box.
If you can find it at all. Whatever.
Duncan, we look forward to. And you've also got Mike King, who's been a good mate of yours as well. You got him on the show. What time's that?
10:30.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for coming into the studio.
And call us. Give us a yell.
Listen to Carly with her bell. Stick around and listen to Debate Club. Help us pick a winner.
Nudge, nudge, wink, wink, she says.
With Tova and Mark.
This is our debate club. It's just like school. And our moderator, Carly Flynn, is in with us. Earlier, we were presented with the moot. It is time to bring back Carless Days. Mark is arguing in the affirmative, bring back Carless Days. I'm arguing in the negative, do not bring back Carless Days. Carless Carly has already picked a side, but you guys get to decide.
It's hard not to have a personal preference, isn't it? But you're going to get 90 seconds each. I've got a bell. I'm going to be ruthless because I've been told with my little dinky little bell here to be ruthless. Mark first, mm-hmm. then Tova.
Do we get like a 30 second?
I'm the new Jessica.
What should I give you? Yeah, exactly. Mark, then Tova. Thank you for picking up on that, Mark. What would you like, a 10 second wind up or?
Yeah, maybe give us a 10 second wind up and then a wrap.
To tell us why we should have Carless Days here on Today FM, the inaugural debate club, here's Mark Dye. Over to you.
Should we bring back carless days? Absolutely. But, for those that remember, unlike the 70s when exemption fraud was rife, this time we actually do it properly. Now, if we're honest, a single day without a car is doable for most of us. And the flow-on effects, considerable, especially for the most important people in our society, our children.
Oh.
Our. Don't have any, but, you know, let's pretend I do. A vote against carless days and any excuse that is thrown around thereafter is therefore a vote against our children.
Oh!
And worse,
this is a
our children's children. Carless days has, of course, been suggested recently to help with congestion. And in the cities, just like during COVID, we would see an immediate impact. Even the slightest reduction in commuter traffic could save days of your life. During COVID, during my commute out to my other job, my business was essential before you start, it was 30 minutes shorter some days. And you add that up over a couple of weeks, you know, that's a lot of time. But the real reason we should be bringing back carless days is because of climate change. A single day a week of each New Zealander leaving the car at home, carpooling with someone or using public transport would have significant impact on our transport emissions. And of course, these are our second biggest emissions. I know for many, climate change is something that we should worry about in a little while. Think of the children. Think of the children. There's nothing more important than the children.
The children and the climate. How do you argue with that? Well, Tova, it's up to you to do that.
But I think we're going to take a break before we get your side. Is that right?
Yeah, you're going to read the headlines.
Stand by for those.
Today FM headlines.
Helicopters and vessels are working to locate a number of people in a significant rescue operation in the far north. A radio beacon was activated off North Cape last night with 5 of the 10 people involved rescued so far. A number of people are unaccounted for and police are assisting with the land search at Tapua. The Health Minister promises there are plenty of beds available in intensive care units. Sandra Little says reports only 4 or 5 remain vacant is simply not true, with 280-odd remaining. And rain is easing in Northland as the worst of it moves towards Auckland and the Coromandel. Met Service says the weather is going to worsen with warnings in place. PureSouthShop.com delivering New Zealand's finest red meat straight to your door. More news as soon as it happens on Today FM.
Thank you, Carly.
I got there on time for the first time all morning.
Great!
Woo! I'm ready now.
It is 8:51, so three, four hours into the gig, exactly. We are acing it.
Exactly.
We're in the midst of our debate club. The moot this morning is, it's time to bring back carless days. You've just heard Mark's argument for carless days, and you're about to hear the winning argument against carless days.
Hang on.
The children, Tova. You cold, heartless something or other.
You want the children to
Who decides? Do I have to pick a side at the end, or who's deciding the winner of this?
Yeah.
Should I give a technical winner?
Get people to text.
Yeah, get in touch with us now. 3920. As you hear the debates unfold, help us pick a winner. Help Carly pick a winner of
debate. Pick a favourite child this morning. Also keen to hear what you think about carless days as well. All right, Tova, your 90 seconds starts now.
I say no to bringing back carless days. They simply didn't work. Not only that, they were inequitable, annoying, ignored. They clogged public transport, which wouldn't be appropriate in these COVID times. And enforcing them was also a waste of police and court time. According to the New Zealand History website, carless days did little to reduce consumption. There goes your climate argument. So didn't serve their purpose at all. It favoured wealthier households with those with two cars getting around the rules. There were even reports of one dude. He had a Rolls Royce and he bought a Honda Civic as a second car to drive on his Rolls-less days. 15% of cars were exempted anyway, and for those who weren't, people just flouted the rules. They were widely considered a joke. When people were busted, like Gordon Marks, the first person to be stung for driving on a carless day after napping at a party and then boosting at 3:45 in the morning, he went before the courts, and although the judge ruled it was an oversight, he's set to make an example of Marks, fining him $50, not the full $400, but what a magnificent waste of court time. Worst of all, it encouraged drunk driving. The carless day was supposed to run from midnight to midnight, but was amended in select committee to instead start at 2 a.m, an allowance for social activities, an amendment which was nicknamed the Boozers Charter. To top it all off, imagine right now the level of state intervention if Jacinda Ardern and her government tried to impose carless days on everyone. Imagine for a second how that's going to go down. Think about it. Exactly. The upshot is carless days were scrapped after less than a year because they sucked.
Oh, she's got 3 seconds to spare.
Death to children is all I'm hearing. We're out of time. We'll find out who won next.
Today FM weather check.
A mostly cloudy day for Canterbury. Expect some drizzle and rain from this afternoon with northeasterlies. More rain at times tomorrow. Clearing tomorrow night. Canterbury high today of 19 degrees.
Today FM traffic.
Decorate and save at Rosine.
A cloudy day ahead around Christchurch and for a high of 20. And if you're coming into the city via Brougham Street, it is slow through Addington again, so expect delays there. Elsewhere, though, the network is pretty quiet. 15 minutes down from Belfast to town on Cranford Street. Just over that, if you're coming in from the airport via Fenlington Road. If you're making your journey up Colombo Street, it's a pretty good run all the way through from Cashmere Road for now.
Get 20% off Rosine premium paints, stains, wallpaper and accessories at Rosine Colour Shops.
Today FM community notices with Lexus of Christchurch. Explore destinations on electricity alone with the new Lexus UX 300e.
There is always something happening at Ferrymead Heritage Park. The night markets are back on the first Saturday of every month, with the first Sunday being Steam Sunday. Trams run every weekend and lots of other themed events throughout the year. Open every day from 10 a.m. for everything happening. Ferrymead Heritage Park on Facebook.
Book a test drive with the all-electric Lexus crossover at lexus.co.nz.
You don't always see motorcyclists with just one look. So every time you indicate, look again, look again, look again, look again. At intersections, look again, look again. Or before you turn, look again, look again. Motorcyclists can be hard to see. Look again. Be sure. A message from ACC and the Motorcycle Safety Levy.
There's still time for Dell's end of financial year deals. Up to 40% off selected PCs preloaded with Windows 11 Pro. Dell recommends Windows 11 Pro for business. Weekly deals end midnight March 24th. Visit dell.co.nz/EOFY. Conditions apply.
Get the great taste of KFC with lunch deals starting from just $5.99. Like the Colonel's lunch with 2 pieces of secret recipe chicken and chips for just $6.99. It's finger-licking good value, only at KFC.
Apply and be approved for Q MasterCard and be in to win a Yamaha Wave Runner worth $17,000. Plus, get your first $50 back when you spend on your card in the first month. With a minimum of 3 months to pay on every purchase, you can do more of what you love to do with Q MasterCard. Apply online at qmastercard.co.nz. Offer ends 18th April. Lending criteria, $50 annual account fee, fees, T's and C's apply. Standard interest rate of 25.99% applies after any interest-free period.
Find out more.
Tova.
With Generate, the KiwiSaver specialists. People you can actually talk to.
On Today FM.
It's 8.56. You heard Debate Club. Should we bring back Carless Days or not? Mark says yes. I say no. Carly says what?
Well, the text machine says, I'm voting to save the children and the planet. I'm going with Mark.
Thank
but
you.
Then, this is interesting. Somebody says Rover. Haha. Autocorrect. Sorry. Tova.
I'll take it.
There you go.
As long as I'm winning, there's no confusion.
I mean, technically, great debates, guys, but I'm going with Mark. I say yes for Carla.
Carla's that's Carly one to Mark.
You can't vote against children, though, can you?
Or grandchildren.
Oh, day one, I'm a loser.
One for Mark.
Thank you very much, Carly. Congratulations, Mark. It's 8.57. It has been a big old morning, a ton of high points, some memorable moments. Winston Peters providing a key one. You've told my producer that you don't want to talk about Tauranga and whether you'll stand in the by-election. Is that because you haven't decided yet whether you want to stand?
Look, you have a lovely day.
No, but Mr. Peters, are you going to stand in the Tauranga by-election? Beep, beep, beep.
And he's gone.
I'm taking that silence as Winston Peters hanging up on me. Okay. Oh, and what of the guy who left that space in Tauranga for Winston Peters to do goodness knows what? Well, he's got more than a passing interest on who'll be standing in his own electorate. And to that end, we thought we might pay a final tribute to Simon Bridges, courtesy of our incredible technical producer, Mr. Jeremy Pickford.
Toto, this is my playing the drums, by the way, Simon Bridges. Oh, 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 oh. Little China girl. Oh, 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 oh. Little China.
I could have gone hang gliding with my China goo.
I'll tell you about China, but not China.
Winston Peters was mean about mining and my China goo.
I don't know anything about that country.
It's not my fault that I sound Kiwi as bro. So I left Parliament. I like Italian food when I'm with my China girl. We like to drink milk, me and my China girl. I hear that Winston might do the by-election. Please do not vote for him.
I don't know anything about that country.
He's a bully. When he was mean to me and the parliament that time, I said, Winston, just you shut your mouth.
I'm the naughty boy in this parliament.
I said, shush. And slushies.
Slushies!
I said, shush. And I was a bit mean about Grant Robertson.
Well, Grant Robertson drank them all.
Oh, 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 oh.
Oh, that's us. Thank you for joining us for our first show.
Day one done. Congratulations.
On 95.3 Christchurch.
Day one done.
This is Today FM News.